eligible delegates list, have one copy of the eligible alternates, got one of the failed for each. And if your name is on here, like, please initial next to your name that you were here. So we'll just start that going this way and then zigzag back to everybody. That's okay with everybody. I'll just put it in one folder for you. Right, you just can. Then in addition,
And then, can y'all hear me without that, or? Okay, then in addition, unfinished business would include resolutions that never made it to the floor, and we have some resolutions here, like I mentioned. And then any other unfinished business that people want to discuss, and then any discussion of what else we care about here. And Russ would just be chairing this.
Okay, we have this meeting room reserved 2 to 5. We've just got an hour, and it's fine if we can't, we have to go 5. And I would like everybody that's here to have a record of this, that those involved, to print your name on this sheet of paper. I'm not asking for your phone number or your address, I just want to print your name.
Your district?
Yes, your district.
Lance Roberts, District 5. So the SCC can approve resolutions. They do resolutions all the time, but they can't approve platform planks, and they can't do rules, except they can create interim rules, which they could do for most of the stuff if they wanted to, that would then have to be reapproved at the state convention, the next state convention. So.
Is there any way to see the rules regarding the nine platforms?
Thank you.
I can circulate the rules list here, but I just have 10 copies of it.
So I have a parliamentarian on the way. When he's here, we'll have more order if he gets out of order.
And we now have a microphone that we can pass around in the crowd.
All right, thank you, Jim. Let's give Gene a hand for setting this up. I had a copy. It was my copy. I think I might have handed it to somebody of the actual agenda of the convention. Does anybody have that with them? Well, mine's in my briefcase in my car, so I'm going to screw up. Here it is, right here. Okay.
Questions,
Mr. Chairman? Yes. Questions, Paul?
Are we have someone
to
volunteer?
Notes? Yeah, minutes? Does anybody want to take minutes as a volunteer? Raise your hand. You need a volunteer to take minutes. Would you stand up, please? Raise your hand. Your name, please. I can't hear you.
Zephyr,
you got to take notes for us? I would like that. Thank you. Yes. Mr. Ward?
Yeah.
Senator?
When the quorum report was given, there wasn't an objection and a challenge. What is the parliamentarian?
When the quorum report was announced at ABT, there was a challenge, there was an objection and a challenge. What does that do? Because it immediately adjourned thereafter. But there was, when the report was given, there was an objection. I object and I challenge. And then it was adjourned. What does our parliamentarian, our eight parliamentarian, or anybody Robert's Rules of Order say about that? Or does anybody know about that?
Our parliamentarian, sure.
Okay, we'll ask him when he gets here.
Fair enough.
Oh, what did you hear? Stand up, please. Weldon Merritt. Weldon, introduce yourself, please, with your credentials.
Okay, I'm Weldon Merritt, a professional registered parliamentarian, credentialed by the National Association of Parliamentarians, a certified parliamentarian, credentialed by the American Institute of Parliamentarians. I wasn't inside when that happened, so I don't know all the details, but the challenge should have been processed, or probably should have been a vote on whether to, I'm not sure exactly the basis of the challenge, because I wasn't there.
But if I don't have a microphone. I know it was said I object, I challenge the report, because I did it. So I know that it was, and then we
need to. My name is Jerry Ward. I know that it was challenged because I said, I challenge, I object to the report. And the fellow running from Fairbanks was sitting next to me, the red haired guy, running against Ralph Seekins. Okay, yes, but I mean, immediately win. So nevertheless, I made a motion. It was an actually heard motion because Randy, who you guys don't know, I've known and have a long history with Randy, he saw me and quickly, goodbye. So what does that actually do? Is it completely up to the chair to recognize an emotion, an objection to an action? Or who is it up to? Because the body did not get to discuss it or vote on it.
The chair is not really, the chair doesn't have a lot of unilateral authority. If there was a legitimate objection or point of order, it should have been processed. Kind of moot now because you're all gone, but it should have been processed because, if you wanted to challenge a portion of the report, and it could have made a difference in whether there was a quorum or not, then it really should have been processed, in my opinion.
I just want to look at the report.
All right, thank you. Well, did you come over here with Tish?
Yes.
She in the building?
I don't know.
No. Thank you. Somebody would take charge of this and serve it in the room as needed. Okay. I do in my briefcase, if you want those.
Well, I think it's just important for people to know that the party rules sometimes supersede parliamentary procedure.
They do.
And so it's good to know in cases that might be used for something out of the party rules, not exceptional reports.
So you're saying to check the party rules so we don't waste our time?
Well, no, I think you should just look to see what party rules say about that. If it provides
some... Well, it's not a bad idea.
Right.
Yeah.
All reports are subject to challenge under the party rules. All.
If they have a procedure in there that's different from parliamentary procedure, that's what you have to figure out which one you have to call.
ARP rules amended. Okay. Are there any other concerns?
Could you repeat what this woman said? Because she didn't have a mic and we couldn't hear it.
Okay, who's got the mic? Identify yourself.
Rebecca Logan from District 23, and I'm a Region 6 Finance Chair on the State Central Committee. What I said was that our party rules supersede parliamentary procedure sometimes. So before you investigate something like that, what the proper procedure is, it's always best to check our party rules to see if we have something outlined in our party rules about how we should proceed. And then if there's nothing, then you go to parliamentary procedure.
Thank you. Does anybody have any objections with that? Okay. And somebody just went to get the party rules, right? And Rebecca, you have it? Bernadette?
I have a question to the parliamentarian through you, Mr. Chairman.
You have a question for the parliamentarian? Is that what
yes.
You okay, through me?
Well, that's just a correct way of saying
it. Yeah, go ahead. Well, why don't you sit up here next to me? Because you're going to get a lot of questions. If you would. You can either sit in this piano bench or you can drag your chair with you. That's fine. Well, she'll ask me the question, I'll ask you, and then I'll give her the answer. Bernadette, go ahead.
I guess besides this gentleman like making his motion there, somebody got point of order out, and he just left anyway. And what I say when I was looking for rules, even though we didn't have a quorum, a meeting can continue as long as it's discussing the quorum and how to meet quorum. And if that is the case, is this can now still be the meeting because of the way it was adjourned a fine day, if that's how you say that, or to a time specific, which this was, because that was announced at the meeting. And does that mean that this now can be the continuation of that meeting as long as we discuss quorum and the only and what kind of things can we discuss at that time?
I would rather you answer that specifically. Well, I don't want to get lost in transmission.
In my opinion, this would not properly be a continuation of the same meeting because there was no proper motion to adjourn to this location and time. There was an announcement that there would be a meeting here, but it wasn't processed and stated as a motion to adjourn to this that meeting to this time and location. But you are correct that even in the absence of the quorum, there are certain procedural things that can be done. And discussing the credentials report to determine whether in fact you have a quorum.
You broke it.
discussing the report to try to figure out whether it's accurate or not certainly would be in order. But it didn't happen, and at this point, probably have no parliamentary solution. Your solution now would be outside of parliamentary procedure.
I have a question for you. If a motion was made, an objection was made to the quorum report, which it was, I know the guy that made it, and then if that was made and other people heard that being made, including the chairman, can it properly be adjourned? With that objection to the report on the floor, can you adjourn, Mr. Parliamentarian?
The chair has no authority to unilaterally adjourn any meeting with two exceptions. One is if you have finished all of the scheduled business and there is no more new business when the chair asks for it. And the other one is if there's an emergency that creates a danger to life and limb, you wait for a proper motion. Otherwise, it is up to the assembly to adjourn. Now, the other, I guess, if you don't have a quorum and you can't conduct business, then there's a few things that you can do, but once you've done those, you still have to adjourn because there's nothing else to be done.
And if I might, very important, the reason that I objected because I did not know whether there was a quorum or not. So as far as I'm concerned, by saying, I object to the report, I contest it, then, see, I still haven't seen the report. I mean, I don't, maybe she has. I don't predict it.
Yeah.
Predict the report. That's what I objected to. Because I wanted to look at it. You know, I can count to 250 real quick.
Sure.
You know?
And I think that would have been in order.
Well, if you think it would have been in order, does that make the adjournment out of order?
It should not have happened. But
no, practically, yes or no. It's okay.
Well, the thing is, it's not that simple. It should not have happened, but once everybody left, it did happen.
Yeah. It was not called the order.
Yeah.
Well, we were ordered away.
Yeah. And that's why I say your solution at this point is not parliamentary procedure. You basically exhausted your parliamentary options. Had everyone remained, there may have been some things that could have been done. Now, if you still didn't have a quorum, it was determined you didn't have a quorum, you couldn't do much of substance, but you could have elected the chair pro tem and proceeded with those things that you can do in the absence of a quorum. And that would include trying to figure out whether, in fact, you have a quorum. And if not, you still could have set a time and location for an adjourned meeting, at which you could have continued if you had a quorum. It all comes down to, do you have a quorum? But, you know, the fact that everybody left that location without officially setting an adjourned meeting basically means that is effectively over.
Well, point of information.
Where's the other microphone? I can't hear you. There, can you have? Who is it?
I think it's somebody.
Justin. I can speak loud. I have kids.
Give it to George.
Okay, so my question is then, if we make the announcement to the body that we're going to meet here for this reconvening, can this action of this body not be considered a vote by action?
What do you mean a vote by action? I mean that.
Well, he said that we were going to reconvene here. We're all forced to leave. Everybody showed up for the reconvening. I would assume everybody here voted in the affirmative to that action.
Yeah, I mean a motion of that.
No, we did do a motion.
I didn't hear it was a motion.
I made a motion that we. I couldn't hear a motion that we agreed. There was a motion on the floor.
Yeah, I remember it.
Seconded it.
So,
to adjourn to this time and
place. I made a motion that we move to the other location with Russ Millette serving as our chair and reconvene at 2 o'clock. I asked for a second, and I believe that that's what the yeas and nays were.
Okay. All right. I did not hear that portion. I probably came in a little bit late.
That was after Randy left already, though.
Well, that doesn't matter. He was just walking up and he made. I just let you know, so you know that was Randy was leaving here. He was already done.
Okay. But he did not have the authority to unilaterally adjourn, so those who were still there could have continued with me. You're limited in what you can do until you determine there's a quorum, but that does change it. It seems to me that motions, if everybody understood it as a motion to adjourn to this location in time, then this can be considered a continuation of that meeting.
How would that been on the record to count then?
Well, someone should have been taking minutes, but if not, even if minutes weren't taken, it's still valid. You can reconstruct the minutes from that meeting. Someone can reconstruct the minutes then, and at some point, those need to be approved by the same process of approving any other minutes. Now, you may get into a lot of dispute as to whether that really was or was not a legitimate motion, but it sounds to me like it was, and you can't, you can do things here that you could have done there, but the key is, do you have a quorum here? Just looking out, I'm not so sure you do.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Lloyd Thurman, District 10. I was handed this by another individual here, and it's page 93.
When I wasn't recording the
page 93 of the Robert's Rules of Orders says the chairman should not take the chair until a quorum is present, except where there is no hope of there being a quorum, and then no business can be transacted except simply, and then it goes down to adjourn. The next page.
Well, there actually are four things. Adjourn is one of the things that can be done. You can also recess. You can set an adjourned meeting, i.e. you can vote to have a continuation of the meeting at a different time and location, or you can take steps to obtain a quorum. Those are the substantive things that can be done. There are other procedural things that can be done that aid in getting to those points. One of them could be selecting a chairman pro tem if you don't have a chairman there. It could be steps to determine if you have a quorum. That would really fall under steps to obtain a quorum. If nobody else saw the report, how do you in fact know that there wasn't a quorum? So there's some procedural things that can be done, but nothing of substance can be done except for those four things that I talked about.
As I may not have a chance to speak later, I think the mistake that we made was by the fact that we allowed it to be held there in a pro chairman establishment, let's put it that way, that if we had had it in an area where we couldn't be manipulated, I think it would have been to our advantage. That's one thing I would have
said. Exactly.
Neutral site.
Yeah.
So may I make a suggestion that in the deference to time so that we can get to the resolutions that we all really want to talk about, that you conduct this meeting as if it is a continuation and quorum and in parliamentary procedure, and somebody takes notes and records minutes, and then somebody gets the Credentials Committee report and validates it or invalidates it. But we can't spend any time discussing that today because we don't have that information. We need that information to move forward on that issue. So conduct it like it's a continuation today, and then somebody should work on validating the credentials report.
Second.
I'd like to ask a question, too, at point of order.
Talk loud.
Yeah.
Can we discuss why we didn't have a quorum? The shenanigans that went on.
I suppose you could discuss it, but I think everybody probably knows.
As a member of the SCC, I would like to see charges taken.
Yeah, and that
as
requires.
There was outright lies.
Yeah, you need to be very careful about saying that in an open meeting like this, what you can do, but you have to have a quorum. But you can move to, assuming you have a quorum in some meeting, you can move to have an investigating committee appointed to investigate whether charges should be brought. You don't actually make charges in an open meeting of this nature. It can lead to some problems if it turns out that your facts are not completely correct.
If we're going forward, as if this is another meeting, do we have to renew a credential?
Well, you need to determine whether you've got a quorum or not. So I would say yes, we need to figure out who's a properly authorized delegate.
I have a concern. I'm Valerie from District Group 2. When I was alternate, and so I was going and asking, you know, am I going to be a delegate? Of course, at first they said, no, if you weren't a delegate before, you're not going to be a delegate now, and they're insisting on that. And then I just kept going back, and they said, well, that's not right, but, you know. And then they finally changed their mind. They said, well, okay. But then I went back a half an hour before around 10 o'clock, and I said, well, how many people are from our district are signed in, and how many are left? They said, 4 slots are left. So, you know, if no one comes in the next half an hour, you'll be delegate. But when the woman came in to tell us how many slots were available, she changed it to 8 slots. But what happened to 4 people that had been signed in? You know, so there was only 4 slots when I asked her, because I looked at the paperwork, and she showed me the 4 that was available. But then when she came to me, all of a sudden there was 8 slots available from our district. Did somebody unsign the name?
I have no idea.
Were they doing stuff at the last minute? I'm just wondering.
You know, delegate camp. Where's that microphone? Where's that other microphone? Somebody pass it up.
Can I say something to that? I'm Karen Perry, District 12, and I was on credentials. Nobody came to me, and where's Willoughby? Weatherby. He's on credentials. As far as I know, nobody came and asked us to have a credentials meeting. We were never notified. We don't know who signed in or who didn't sign up. It never happened.
We're not infected.
I'm also on credentials, and everything that we saw within the districts that I was working with was accurate. It was put in, but however, the problem I saw, who was the lady who was running?
Gloria.
She was adding up the credentials on her computer. And so therefore, no, I don't know of anybody being able to follow that as far as the validation of that. But so therefore, there was a question. Then there was a quick meeting of where they pulled a small portion of credentials to the side, of which a parliamentarian, as I understood his position to be, not you, but a parliamentarian from California, Sacramento, was brought up. And he was there and basically said that the factor was 275 for the quorum, and that 192 was what we had. And so therefore that there was not a quorum, and that was a statement that he had made from the figures that she gave off of her computer to him. I don't know of anybody who validated the fact of being able to see and those numbers. We knew it was correct off of the sheets from the people who came in and were credentialed. We knew that to be a fact, but the final addition portion, I don't know that there were people there to be able to validate.
Did you count the 192?
One more time.
Did you count the 192? Are you on the committee?
Yes.
Did you count
the 192? No, that's what I just said.
Did anybody count to it?
She did it from her computer and everything else.
Anybody here?
Point of information, I did count the number of people in the gymnasium that the security was letting through with badges, and the highest number I came up with was 222.
Oh, boy.
I also did a count, and my count would comport with Justin's.
I was with Gloria when she was missing those fingers into her I walked along with her as she was giving those numbers from each table, and I believe they're accurate. I don't think it's worth arguing about it.
It's too late.
They sabotaged this last bit of the convention, and it worked. There's, I think, an act of evil, but it worked. So we just got to talk about the future now.
Is it all the alternates were moved up?
They moved alternates up.
All of them that were authorized?
There weren't that many. I don't know how many moved up.
There was only
192 is so far away from 275 or even 236, which is what I thought it should be. That we just didn't have the numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Jack, go ahead.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I was a former assembly president. He and I led the borough and chaired hundreds of public meetings. I agree with the parliamentarian that no chairman has the unilateral authority to stop a meeting. And based on that, I'm going to make a motion that we continue the meeting and that we elect Russ Millett as chairman pro tem. Is that the correct terminology? Chairman pro tem to continue the meeting.
Second.
And you should elect a secretary pro tem.
Who's taking notes?
Okay, just before we do that, can I have a question, Mr. Parliamentarian?
No, I just said you should also elect a secretary pro tem unless the actual secretary is here and prepared to.
Yeah, I'm not opposed to that, but just let me advise you.
She stands up.
Let me advise you something. Alice?
Yeah, I'm Alice, district 32 secretary. I'd like to ask people who are more familiar with the Republican Party rules to make sure there's not a conflict with the presiding secretary taking minutes of this proceeding.
Okay.
Before we point of order, there's a motion and a second on the floor.
There's a motion and a second before I'm going to call that we not entertain that right now. And I want to dismiss the meeting for a recess, if not dismiss it, recess it for 10 minutes so we can discuss this. And we can determine where we're at in terms of the rules. Okay. I want you all to be protected as well as your chairman, or chairman-elect. So we're going to recess for 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll come back to that motion. Thank you. Thank you. I want to raise your hands on the next question.
Kind of a wrap.
How many of you in this room that are delegates to this?
Yes. So anyway,
what was supposed to happen? How many of you in this room that are delegates?
Okay.
If it just passed the ARP convention, want to see me become chairman of the ARP in February. Please raise your hand. Thank you. In February 2013, is that right? Thank you.
All right.
My question still stands. Thank you. For that reason, I'm going to call the last motion out of order and discuss this with wise counselors, one of them being myself. I want to be your chairman in February of 2013, or whenever it's called for. I don't want to jeopardize that for the sake of those in this room, or the Republican Party in this state, which I intend to not harm me in any way. So therefore, I'm calling the last motion out of order and calling for it. Chairman pro tem or temporary chairman of those gathered here, and I'll take nominations of the floor to continue this meeting, then you decide what kind of meeting you want.
Well, my motion still stands, and I nominate you as chairman pro tem for this meeting.
Could you name your name and district, please?
Jack Brown, District 30.
Okay, we have an objection over here.
Objection, Jerry Ward, District 7. It's not proper for him or the young lady to say that she was secretary to chair this meeting, and so I respectfully request you to withdraw that. I'd like to nominate another person to chair it so that there is not a problem with national.
I withdraw.
Thank you very much, Jack. Motion's withdrawn. So I'm going to take nominations from the floor. If anybody that wants to nominate anybody to be the temporary chair of this gathering today.
I'd like to nominate, this is George Martin.
George? 29. District what, sir?
29.
George Martin.
I'll nominate Jerry Ward.
Jerry Ward has been nominated. Any other nominations?
Saka, sir.
Saka.
You guys are going to fight it out over there, or are you going to accept that nomination?
He wouldn't tell me his name.
Okay. All right. There's been a motion made, a first and a second, to nominate Jerry Ward as temporary chairman of this meeting. All in favor, raise your hand. Senator Ward, thank you very much. The motion passes. Thank you, Jack. Jack, you made that motion, didn't you?
George
made it. Okay, George. Thank you for withdrawing that, Jack, and thank you for making that motion, Mr. Martin. All right. So this is your temporary chairman. He's going to discuss what you want to do with this meeting. Okay? Now, what I presented to you was one thing. What I was asked to do was one thing. and all of a sudden it turns into something else. I don't want to jeopardize any of us, especially me. Thank you. I nominate Zephyrin Dalton to be temporary secretary of this meeting.
Second.
Oh, you're right. Okay, go ahead. And it's seconded by who?
Phil Prox, District 3.
Hey, do we need anything more than a chairman and a secretary? Go ahead.
We technically need an official name for the group, just for the record. Committee for the Republicans' Future, or something like that.
All right, we'll write a name down in just a minute. Okay, all right. Then what we would be, go ahead.
I just want to point out to people that we're not at a private meeting. We have members of the media here, and there are people who don't often write kind things about the Republican Party. So just be cautious about what you say here, okay?
Thank you. Well, we don't have ADN in the Alaska Dispatch. All right. I need one assistant to help go through this, so I'd like to somebody nominate you.
No.
We're going to go through these rule of resolutions and approve them. No. Yes.
Yes.
No.
What I want to ask is before
somebody needs to take a microphone back there so everybody can hear this instead of just me babbling here. All right. Wait till you get the microphone. Let him go first, okay? All right, I'm calling you. Go ahead.
Now, I was just going to say, before we're assigning people to do duties, the point that Russ brought up is, what is this meeting, and what is our purpose? That needs to be determined before we go figuring out duties and roles.
Yep. Agreed.
If we even need to have this level of formality.
Apparently we do, because we've already elected me temporarily, so we have that much. Okay, let's answer the question. I don't know the name of it, and I don't know totally why yet, but yes, go ahead.
Dave McGraw, District 9, that's my name.
Yeah, thank you, little thing, Dave.
I move that we call this the Ad Hoc Committee to Help the Arb.
Ad Hoc Committee to Help what?
Help the Arb.
The ARB. Second by George Martin, District what?
29.
29. Okay, so that's the official name of it. You got it? All right. Okay, and do it by microphone only. You can hand the microphone to this young lady right here.
I have a loud enough voice. I make a motion that those who were not delegates or assistants that were not part of the convention, that they not be participants within these meetings, such as news media, etc.
No second to it, so.
I second.
Thank you.
All right, are you asking to exclude the media from this meeting?
Absolutely. Because I don't want any misinterpretation or anything else here.
I'm going to.
In relation to this. We all are well aware, with no disregard or disrespect to those who are in the news media, but we also know how much that certain things get misinterpreted and come out in a different way.
I couldn't agree with you more, and I'm going to speak to it because I object to the motion. And I'll tell you right now, I don't particularly care for the media. Nobody has ever said a kind word about me in the media one time in my entire life, nor will they. But, I don't want to be a part of anybody that throws the media out or anybody else. I'll tell you what, that's not what I'm about. We still have the other motion pending. Hold on, I'll get right back to you. What was the other motion? Okay. Everybody in favor of naming the group that Dave's, can you read it to us?
The Ad Hoc Committee to Help the
ARB. Point of order,
Yeah, we're on, okay, but we're on the motion?
Well, then I don't want to.
No, go ahead on point of order for the motion.
Yes. Karen
Perry, District 12, Marsh Davis, I love you dearly. I don't care for the name ad hoc because as far as I'm concerned, we are the real Republican Party. We are the ones sticking to the rules.
It's a friendly amendment, David.
Friendly amendment.
Friendly amendment, go ahead. Name, please say your name. District.
District 45. It's a friendly amendment. Just eliminate the word ad hoc in front of it.
Yeah.
For continuation.
David, objection to the friendly amendment?
Oh, except any friendly amendment.
Yeah.
Except any friendly amendment. Can you read it in full with the friendly amendment to it, the ad word ad hoc out?
I'm sorry.
Just take the word ad hoc.
Oh, okay. Committee to help the ARP.
Is there an objection to this being called the committee to help the ARP? Hearing none, we are now organized as that group. Okay, and okay, now to the next motion. The gentleman wanted to remove all non-delegates and alternates from the room. You made the motion and like to speak to the motion. Can you get a microphone wherever it is?
I can speak loud. That's okay. I still want to over talk into it. My suggestion.
Name and district.
Sorry, Justin Carroll, District 33. The media, we need to start working with them to get them to work with us anyways, in all due respect to what Santa Claus has suggested, that perhaps for the sake of not having them mixed in with the group, so there's no accidental voting, if we could just have the delegates and those authorized to vote on the floor and the rafters for the rest for observation.
Okay, I would just to clarify what the gentleman had suggested that to your motion was to just, if you're here from the media or you're not a delegate or an alternate, please don't voice an opinion, don't speak, and don't vote. Okay? How's that?
Second?
The second floor makes it easy for separation.
Yes. Good point.
All right. Debbie, Vice Chair, can you take the microphone over to her? Who has the microphone? Okay, great. They finally got somebody running microphones around. Now watch this move. This is going to be fun. Debbie
Brown, District 30, Kenai Peninsula. If we set the purpose and our goals and objectives for this meeting soon, I think then we'll know better how official we need to be about who may be participating. Because had we named this organization the ad hoc ARP to help however it went. It's sort of an informal name. It really doesn't indicate. So what is the name again? And then could you help me understand by the choice of that name, what exactly we are going to try to accomplish? Because if it's nothing official, if it has nothing official to do with any of the work of the standing committees, then that changes things quite a bit.
No, actually, what's going to happen here today, at the end of the day, we're going to summarize what has happened here. We're going to turn it over to the new chairman and to the new officers and to the old officers so that they know we did have a meeting and something happened. This will be put down into a file. Even if we stop right now, the simple fact that we had a meeting will continue. And this will be submitted to the existing officers and the future officers of the Republican Party, and we can submit it to national too. I mean, that's what we are. We're Republicans. We get to do that. Where is the microphone? Okay. Go ahead. Will you hand her, and then we'll work our way up here. Go ahead.
Tina Chapman, District 19. I just wanted to offer a friendly amendment to moving the people who are not delegates up to the rafters. That instead of they are not allowed to speak, that maybe we set a time frame when anybody who is here as a guest or even the press would have an opportunity to make a statement or ask questions, because I don't want to shut anybody out or up.
I think that's entirely right. But right now, we'll let the people that are delegates and alternates speak, and of course, they'll be given time at the end if you want to say something. The people that are not delegates or alternates. Yes, right up here. And then
to the motion, we should all be speaking to the motion, which was a motion to move, ask the media not to be here. with all these people in this room have so many passionate ideas about what we need to do to move this party forward, I can pretty much guarantee that we are going to talk about strategy in here. That's not something we want in the media. It's our party strategy. We're going to have discussions about that today. So I will speak in support of the motion to ask the media to leave.
Yes, go ahead. Right here.
Bill Topol, District 25, just a request for information, and I'm hoping to try to speak to the motion as to why we should either vote it up or vote it down. And it also tags along with what Debbie Brown also said and asked as well. And maybe at this time, if it's not too far of a tangent, could we ask ourselves or ask the advice of the parliamentarian in terms of the purpose, so we know whether we're moving the media or not, if we're going to be going by rules for a mass meeting or rules for a continuation of a convention, maybe requesting that information as some advice from the parliamentarian as to help us determine what to do with the media. Anyway.
My opinion evolved a little bit to borrow a word used by a different politician. Because when I got here, I had assumed that the previous meeting had not that you did not have a motion to adjourn to this time and place, and then it sounded like you did, and so I said, well, this was a legal continuation. Now you've decided, in effect, that it is not, so I'm not going to second guess this body's decision that this is not, in fact, a continuation of that meeting. This is a new mass meeting. So you have, in effect, decided that you didn't properly adjourn to this meeting. So this is now a mass meeting, and it goes by the rules of mass meeting in which the quorum is those who are invited can attend. And yes, as such, you're not bound by any, at least, now I'm not giving this as a legal opinion, but as a parliamentary opinion, the only people who are authorized to be here are those who are invited. And so it would be proper to ask anyone who is not specifically invited to leave.
Yes, give the gentleman a microphone back here.
I needed extra eyes.
I can't believe that I'm arguing to keep the press here. This is unbelievable.
Mr. Chairman, I speak in opposition to the motion to exclude the media. Oh, sorry, Sean Godfrey, District 23. I speak in opposition to the motion. I think it would be contrary to the interests of the First Amendment and transparency and to be excluding anybody from our meetings. That's what a lot of the old guard Republicans have been doing to us and others. And I would ask that we allow anybody who wants to observe to remain. Thank you.
All right, and the next one is over on this side. And I'm not picking them.
They're doing this on purpose.
They're doing it on purpose.
Barbara Anderson, District 28.
Go ahead, Barbara.
Two things. Was the motion ever acknowledged by the chair?
Yes.
And then it was seconded. And my other one pertains to this. I put a copy down there of the convention rules, and there's one copy. Would anything in there state whether or not the media was invited at our convention? And there was media at our first part.
Yes, they were invited. They were there. I saw an interview with Joe Miller. Jack, you're next.
This is kind of a point of order. There has not been a vote here to say the continuation. I have not had that opportunity to vote.
Right.
So I think we're doing the same thing that they did to us in the other meetings. I would like to see a vote after this issue is taken care of, because I want to see how many believe this is a continuation.
All right, then. Right now, your motion's out of order because it's got to do with his. Your motion is still to exclude. Is that correct, or did you withdraw it?
No, I still have it before the
call for the question.
Okay. Those people that we are now, the motion is, let me state it clearly, for all people that are not delegates and Republican convention, shall they be asked to leave this meeting of Republicans?
Or am I against?
Well, then again, okay, is that our invited guest? Is that what you're saying?
You're just eliminating the press.
We only have issues with the media. There are people here who are not media delegates or alternates.
Do you want to talk?
Me, for example.
You're the only media here. Yeah, you're it. Hey, somebody give her a microphone, okay?
Media here, so yeah, maybe we could just all look at me when we talk about the media. My name is Amanda Coyne, and I'm with the Alaska Dispatch, and I, in fact, was invited here. The woman who's taking notes there at the table asked me to come here. She said it would be really good if I did come here, and I think there was somebody who else invited me. If you dare raise your hand. I know who you are, by the way.
All right, and then
here's our photographer, Lauren Holmes, too.
Okay, they were invited. Do you want to amend it to where invited people are not allowed?
Let's just leave it with the news media. We'll leave it at that, and therefore...
Okay, all right, all in favor of the news media that aren't invited to go away, signify by saying aye.
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 Okay, all those opposed? The ayes. Go ahead.
Who's being allowed to vote? We haven't determined.
Well, right now I'm going to determine that everybody currently here is allowed to vote. Then we're going to go to Jack's rules. His motion's next. We should have had it first. You're correct. That's correct, but we don't. So once we're done with this, and by the way, we just allowed everybody to stay. On that motion, we can come back and revisit it, but that's side one. All right, now to Jack on this side, of course. Okay, you got to take up the microphone.
Name and district, Mr. Brown.
Jack Brown, District 30. I'd like to make a motion that this meeting is a continuation of our previous meeting. And the reason for that is...
The motion has been made. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay, second by who? Name, please, and district?
Laura Temple, District 12.
All right, motion has been made and seconded. Discussion. Jack?
Well, finish that sentence.
Well, for several reasons. One, the chairman does not have the authority to unilaterally not recognize proper motions. And we've had at least two proper motions that were made the end of the meeting, they weren't recognized. That's not right. We cannot allow one person to dominate our lives.
All right. Name and district, please, and then we'll come around here. Lance Roberts, District 5. This can't be continued because we didn't have a quorum. And as the parliamentarian has already pointed out, there's only certain things you can do without a quorum. And I don't think that we really want to do any of those four things. We've already adjourned, so that one by itself would be useless. So we don't need to have this as a continuation. That's certainly not why I came here. So that's fine. Okay, all right. And this, go get him since you're back there, then we'll come up this way.
Michael Malin, District 32, just point of information. But even if we did make this legitimate, the only thing we can discuss is the quorum, correct? So wouldn't that not even matter?
Yeah. Maybe yeah. Point of information?
Point of information, go ahead. Where are you?
I'm up here.
Oh, speak loudly. And then bring the microphone up to this gentleman.
I don't need the microphone.
Go ahead.
I don't need the microphone. I'm out of
color,
District 27. When I made the original motion on the floor at the, which was recognized by the chair who had abandoned us, I had motioned that we have an advisory meeting here, that we continue this meeting to have an advisory meeting for the purpose of all the assembled delegates that did bother to show up, to be able to go through the motions of what we would have done had there been a quorum, so that we can give a report to the SCC on how we felt about all those things, so that they wouldn't be moving on in the absence of the input from the delegates who bothered to show up. And that was it. So that was my point of information.
That's the motion I made, which I actually called a vote for, and I got all yays except for one nay, and by my count, I could have missed one. But that's what I thought we were coming here for. And so I feel like all this discussion has slowed us down from getting to the point of order, and I would move that that understanding just be readopted. That was the understanding that I invited you.
If you're trying to make a motion to amend his motion, make it clearly and decisively, I'll repeat it. Go ahead.
Okay, I move to amend his motion by substituting the language of and saying that we're basically having an advisory meeting here of the delegates and alternates that showed up to the convention and were left without a quorum in the announcement of the chair. And that this advisory meeting is to advise the State Central Committee on how we feel and we'll vote on all the agenda items as we had a quorum.
My gosh, okay. That was a friendly amendment since he made the original motion. Is that acceptable?
Yes.
Okay. Is everybody in favor of his motion? All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
Okay, you got it. Whatever it is you said, I hope you voted. Since now we know who invited the press, so okay. Yes, right in front here with the microphone.
Make a motion that we had adopted an agenda for this meeting. The first item on the agenda be to deal with the party platforms that weren't dealt with at the convention and to get a sense of this group about how they feel about that. And I believe it's only the Constitutional Committee that we have for that. And then the second item would be to deal with resolutions that were not dealt with at the convention. And the third item would be new business where people could bring up other topics beyond those two.
All right, that's
motion. My motion.
Her motion is to make those three items the beginning of our meeting here. Is there a second?
Sarah.
Second,
Sarah.
Your name?
Sarah.
All right, all those in favor, okay, question on the motion?
Do we need to adopt a quorum rule first?
No, not. No, we don't. No. It's a quorum of the whole. It's just right here. If half plus one votes on something that are at the meeting, they are authorized to be here. Go ahead, name and district.
Yeah, Frank Turner, District 4. I'm trying to clarify what Lance just came up here a few minutes ago and said under CC rules or something.
Central Committee.
Yeah, Central Committee, we could not discuss that one. So I'd like him to clarify that. I'd like to see the rules. He just came up here about a half hour ago and said we could not discuss the platform, but we could discuss the resolution.
We can discuss anything. We're a committee of the whole. When you're a committee of the whole, you can discuss, take any actions that you are. Does anybody care in the back of the room, please? No. Don't run away now that you've made that motion. Go ahead. But yes, we're authorized to do anything. Go ahead.
Well, I'm not sure what motion is on the floor. Cam Carlson, District 5.
Go ahead.
At the time of the convention, now 2. Who knows what when. But I have been here for an hour and 15 minutes, and we have clacked our gums and spun our wheels and wrapped ourselves around the axle with minutiae. What are we here for? I thought we were here to discuss resolutions, planks, and things we want the Central Committee to be aware of that we feel and think.
Okay.
Let's get down to it. The goal for you all here, whether you like Randy Rundrick or anybody else, is to beat the Democrats. So let's get with it.
All right, with that, we'll go to the rules of the state convention. Is that correct? Yes, it is. All right, what I'm going to do, since we're not going to pass all these out, I will read the 11 rules. Lance, come read these, and then what we're going to do. If there's an objection, I want you to understand this before I let Lance do this, because I have run these meetings before. He's going to read 11 rules. He's going to number them. You're going to read this?
This was the end of it.
All right, but listen, as he reads them, keep them in your mind, and I'm going to ask if there's any objections to any one of them.
Lance.
Which rules are we talking about, Lance? What do you want to approve?
This is the Rules Committee report.
All right, go ahead. And now listen, because we don't have copies of it, if there's parts of it you object to, he's going to identify those parts.
Okay.
But there's no other way to do this because we don't have enough copies for everybody. Keep those in mind, and we're going to approve the what he's about to present to us other than what you have objections to.
You understand?
Is this,
the rules committee report that we did not get to present at the convention. Okay, so I'll just go over, I'm not going to read every little rule change here, but I'll go over what each one is and just try to show what we're trying to do. So the first one, we're going to clarify the National Committee Man, Committee Woman rules because the issue was brought up, even though we had lots of precedent in the past for people in public office being National Committee Man or Committee Woman, and they have exceptions in the rule that the language wasn't clear in some point. So we're going to clarify that, and we just add a few words in here and change a few words, and that gets clarified. Now, I sent this rule out to every delegate I had an email for these rule changes, so most of you guys probably got it. I'm sure that there's some who didn't. Lots of emails bounced. There's a few, but we can certainly get that to you for the exact specifics. So the first section, all it does is clarify that the National Committee Man and Committee Woman can also hold public office and run for public office, and that's it. State office, I mean, partisan office. Right now, you can run for a nonpartisan, like a local assembly or something, and that's no big deal. But if you're running for state senator or legislator, you can be on the SCC unless you're a National Committee Man or National Committee Woman, and that's what this rule was just clarification for.
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead, George.
Was her motion dealt with?
Yes. We're dealing with it right now. Her motion was to deal with these three items. We're starting to deal with it. The lady in the back of the room.
We didn't vote for her on her motion.
Yeah, that's true.
We have not set an agenda.
My motion was to accept the agenda.
Point of information, I know my very wordy motion that we all voted yes on.
Yes.
Included going over the finished, unfinished business, the unfinished business of that convention as though we were doing the convention. This is on the agenda, the Rules Committee report, so are any other unfinished reports.
Okay.
All right, very good. Then we've already, your motion was incorporated into his lengthy word. Okay. Is there any objection to adopting the report as our agenda? Is there any objection to it?
No.
Yes.
Yes.
Debbie Brown, District 30.
Go ahead.
Now, just let me get this. The motion, the amendment that Evan Cutler made to Jack Brown's motion that he accepted as a, I guess you could say, a friendly amendment, which really doesn't exist, but nevertheless we did it. That motion passed, and I believe that Evan is correct, that his amendment to that motion, and essentially the motion passed, included all of the detail that we needed to proceed. However, Rebecca proceeded to make another motion, which you accepted, Mr. Chairman, and it received a second, I believe.
Yes.
And so we do have a motion on the floor that we have to deal with, according to George, using George's terminology. So that is on the floor, and it is in order to move. Even though it might be a little bit repetitious, it may essentially accomplish the same thing, but it should be up or down on that motion. Thank you.
It's not repetitious because it says agenda. It clarified what Evan said. Do you remember what we didn't do at the convention?
Start with the committee reports, as you would at the convention, go to the resolutions, but I added new business at the end so that if there were people here who wanted to bring up other topics for discussion, they would have that opportunity. Evan's motion did not allow for that.
I second that.
All right, okay, very good. Listen.
Point of order.
No, here's the point of order, all right? They're correct, there is one. From now on, and I hate to do this, listen to everybody, when you talk, go through the chair, because that way we will get done with this. I guarantee you, okay? You go through me, we will get done. The motion is to adopt the business that was to be presented at the meeting. All those in favor and the reports that were to be acted on, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. That's so adopted. All right, okay, now we go to the first issue is whether or not only the Republican Party state committee man and committee woman will be able to run for office and hold an office on the Republican Central Committee. Is that correct?
it's a clarification of what was already true, but we're just clearing wording.
Okay, and that is there any discussion on whether or not the National Republican man and National Republican woman should be able to hold office in the Republican Party and run for partisan office at the same time? Is there a motion? Okay, well, no, actually, we don't need motions on this. We're going to keep going through this.
All right, the next one is actually no longer relevant, but just to let you know what it was. The SCC is not allowed to set up new regions when redistricting happens, though they're going to cheat this time and do it anyway. But they're not allowed to do that. They can't even do that with an interim rule. It's something that can only be done at the state convention. So the rule we put up, because redistricting wasn't completed at the time of the state convention, was to allow the SCC this one time to set those regions. Of course, the rule didn't come up, it didn't get approved, so they're going to cheat the system and set regions anyway. But that's the rule. So it's no longer relevant and won't matter. The SCC won't be here about passing that rule. The next one is removing the time delay on proposed rule changes. Yeah.
He's reading it now.
So the rules right now, the rule states, the rules may be amended at any regular ARP state convention or at any special ARP state convention by a majority of the delegates duly voting at a properly called convention. And then it says, and this is the phrase that's going to be deleted, all recommended rule changes made by the district convention shall be forwarded to the state rules committee 15 or more calendar days before the date of the state convention. So it just removes this time delay for the districts getting the rule changes in.
Is there a motion? And we might as well, because let's see, the first one, we did ask about if there's an opposition to National Committee Men and National Committee Women. This is an important fact. Do we want to remove the 15 days to go to the Central Committee at the recommendations of the subcommittee? Is the body no? Microphone up here, please.
I guess my suggestion on this whole thing procedurally to get through it would be to go through the entire report.
That's what I was trying to do.
Note if there are any objections. If there aren't any, then the body can vote on forwarding this to the SCC and stating that it's a sense of the body that this report should pass as written. Or if any.
Okay, then why don't you, hold on. Which one of you two want to read the whole report?
I want to clarify.
Okay, all right, but you know what she just asked. Okay, she was just going to read the whole thing and get it approved instead of beating the horse to death.
Yeah.
Okay, I was just going to clarify this rule change. We removed the 15-day, which would actually make it the 30 days. This was actually a conflict in the rules, and David reminded me that this we were just removing this so that any rule changes are due 30 days before the convention. Right, David?
Right.
Thanks.
All right, now, what I tried to do before is have it all read at once, keep track of it. I'm going to now have them read the whole thing, and I'm going to ask for approval of it all. If there's parts of it that you don't like, then we're going to pull that out. So why don't you go through the whole thing, all your changes that you've made at one time. You can do it. Is there only one more?
No.
Keep going.
That's the big ones, yeah.
All right, so the next one is really simple, actually. The next one just makes district chairman automatic delegates. The chairman, you know, is supposed to be there to lead his delegation, and while I don't think it's happened yet, it certainly came close this last time, where some district chairmen may not have been elected as delegates, and kind of complicates the process, and so we just want to make it so that the district chairmen are automatically delegates to the state convention. That's all that is.
That has nothing to do with. Debbie,
yes.
Brown, District 30, just a question. That's not waiving that Debbie Brown, District 30. That would not be waiving any fees necessarily, would it?
No, not free. It just means you're not elected. You're automatically a delegate. And
so hypothetically, if District 30 was allotted 16, we would just know that the number one position would belong to the chair automatically, and there'd be 15 others that would accompany that individual?
Yes.
Very well.
Well,
if there's a, is there comments on that part, the automatic chair? Go ahead, speak loudly, please.
Okay. I was on a rules committee, this came up. No delegate is to be appointed, they're all to be elected. One district said all the officers that were elected would be appointed as delegates. And we had to look at that. My problem with this is, let's say someone says, I want to be the chairman of this district. I'll do a good job, but I can't make it to the convention. What this is allowing is for people to say in the district, well, the district chairman is automatically a delegate, so you will either have to not go and let an alternate come, or it'll complicate the whole process. I don't think it's fair to change the rule to allow an appointed delegate when the rule says that all delegates should be elected and not appointed.
Hey, can you bring the microphone over here, please?
I don't need a microphone.
Go loudly,
my
very loudly.
My information is that actually elected officials are made honorary delegates, and so there are some circumstances already where they are. It's just not during presidential election years that those circumstances prevail.
Go ahead. And I think it was the sense of the committee that, from memory, which my memory is weak, you're welcome to correct me, and the others who are on the rules committee, but the sense was that if the district chairman couldn't make it, which certainly happens sometimes, then there would just be no automatic delegate slot, and you just elect another person to fill that delegate slot. All right, lady back here.
He said what she was going to say.
Okay, go ahead.
Lori Thurman, District 10. I was with Bill and credentials, and it created a whole bag of worms. So I do not agree with the fact of it being an automatic situation. The stipulation for some of the elected officials, which were the highest ones in the state, they were given that grant, that status. But for everybody else, it created a real bag of worms.
All right, any other discussion on the, go ahead.
To clarify.
Name and district.
David Eastman, District 6, and I was on that committee as well. What the effect of the proposed rule is to give first priority to your district chairman. Just as if you had a Republican state senator or state house representative, those are the three people who would get first dibs on an elected slot before the election even happens, and that's their opportunity to say, yes, I'm going, or no, and then there's an election that happens for everybody else.
And I'd like to point out that we didn't have this rule for this session, so there weren't supposed to be any automatic delegates, though I understand some districts messed up with that. But the confusion wasn't caused by following the rules, it was caused by failing the rules. All right, there is an objection, and it's abstain on that part of it. Go to the next part. We'll vote on all the objections. We're going to get through the ones that have no objection.
Secretary, note that there's an objection on that one. Go ahead.
Okay, so the next one is to require some small notice for the nominations committee report at the district and state convention. Basically, after the nominations, if you have a nominations committee, not all districts do that, come out with a slate, then this is to give 15 minutes so that people can look at that without having to immediately vote on them. They're given 15 minutes to look at the slate of delegates, and that's it.
Okay, so the next one, should be no objection to that one.
Time frame for delegates to pay fees for the state convention. So this was, of course, a big issue. And the one that was arrived at by the Rules Committee says, registration fees for delegates shall be due to the district secretary within 3 calendar days of the adjournment of the district convention at which the delegate was elected. And registration fees for alternate delegates shall be due to the district secretary within 7 calendar days of the district convention at which the alternate delegate was elected. And then the amendment part that when all the paperwork is filed within 10 days by the district that they send the fees with.
Okay. I'd like to speak to that.
Go ahead.
Karen Perry,
District 12. Wait, take the microphone. People cannot hear all the way in the back.
Karen Perry, District 12.
Yes.
I'm speaking to that because I was in credentials, and there was a lot of trouble with when did they pay, when did they did, and of course we didn't have the most, I don't know, on top of it, secretary as far as paperwork, but I'd like to know the difference between the 3 calendar days for the delegates and 7 for the alternates, and I would like to choose one date on the calendar. We all know April 15th is IRS day. Pick one date, since all the district things happen on different days,
and it eliminates a lot of confusion. One day and one day only, all the paperwork and fees must be in.
Objection sustained.
All right, over here, Ms. Kennelly.
I think that ultimately, you know, if people are going to be delegates, when they can pay shouldn't be an issue. Ultimately, we had people that wanted to pay on that day, but they weren't allowed. And I think that for the sense of fairness and inclusion, for as many of the members as possible, for as much transparency as we can accomplish, then they should just be able to pay on the day of the convention and be good with it.
Yes.
I don't disagree with that at all. They wouldn't let me pay my first day. Microphone first. And state your name and district, please.
Valerie Main, District 32 in Juneau. The reason that we had to pay within a couple days of ours is they said they needed the money to be able to get the hall, you know, pay for it up front. And that's why we had to pay. But then when I was an alternate, and paid my $250 along with the rest of my family. And then when we got here, when they were asking for the alternates to be, you know, and they made us pay them, they said, you can't go, you know, or can't be part of it. They said they took somebody else that hadn't paid at all. It's like somebody ran out of the room, says, oh, go get, what's his name, I forget what his name was. Make him go pay now so he can be a delegate. And just, you know, jumped over the whole loop of everybody and then became a delegate. And I was here, and I said, I'm next.
All right, and what this rule change does, it clarifies in writing that that it gives a unified time frame to pay it in. And that's really what it does. And we, instead of getting lost in the woods, picking different days, are the 3 days and the 7 days appropriate for everybody? That's really the question. And right now there are none, so this clarifies it. Okay, go ahead. Back there, she's now going to take the microphone. Name and district.
Bethany Markham, District 24, point of order. Since there's apparently discussion going on about this, aren't we supposed to be skipping this one and going on to the next one and then coming back to it?
Well, I thought we almost had it killed, but you're correct. All right. Is there still an objection to this one?
Yes.
Okay, then, all right, go to the next one.
Okay, now the big one. All right. Term limit rules. So the first thing is to eliminate it at the district level. And actually, it's not completely eliminated. What we do is we go to like a 30-day overlap, to where the old district chairs for 30 days, and the purpose of that being because you've got all that convention paperwork to file and the new district chair doesn't necessarily know how to do any of that paperwork or file it. So, but we take it down from the, you know, 8 months or a year that it is now down to a 30-day time frame. And then you do it at the state level. Now the state is a little different. The state immediately switches without the 30 days, but the state chair becomes the state chair emeritus. He's got a place on the SCC and the SCC, I believe. And non-voting, that's it. Yeah. No, he's a voting member of the SCC and a non-voting member of the SEC, I believe. And so the state chair would immediately go assume the role. The ex-state chair, the state chair emeritus, would have an advisory role, and that would happen immediately because he could advise him through all the paperwork. And you assume in that situation you're going to get more cooperation to get that paperwork done. It's a lot harder on the district level.
So state, immediate, local, 30 days. Is there any objection to this provision? Which would be Randy would have been gone and Russ would have been in. Is there any objection? Just you? Okay. Microphone, please.
So the way this is written, if that happened with the state party chair, so the state party chair would become the state chair emeriti and would be on the central committee. So the state chair, the way this is written, the new state chair would serve as the new state chair and the state finance chair.
Correct.
No. That's what it says here. The state chair elect shall serve as the state finance committee chair until February 1st. Yes.
Point to the brackets. Point to the brackets.
I see the brackets. Yeah.
So we're eliminating.
You're eliminating that. Thank you. That was the point of order. Thank you.
All right. Is there any objection to this? Okay. Going on to the next one. Objection back here. Microphone, please.
Objection.
Thought we had got 2 pages done right then. Well, 3 pages then. Go ahead, name and district.
Ann Carlson, District 5. For the state chairman to take over right after the convention, then that person would be responsible for all the final reports, right?
Correct.
But wouldn't it be more logical for the person that had to run the convention to do those reports?
You're asking, that's a good question, but no,
I would say at least a week for that, for the old chair to clean up his desk.
So to address that, the point was that the state chair emeritus would stick around and help the state chair put that through. That's the idea. He's also, you know, the new state chair needs to be ready at that SCC meeting that's after the state convention to be able to make his appointments. Otherwise you're going to have to put it off the new appointments for treasurer and whatever positions are appointed off until the next SCC meeting, which could be quite a while. A lot of times that summer one gets really pushed out sometimes. Which incidentally, that is the way that the Republican Party had done it for years, up until a few years ago. Go ahead. Name a district. You're objecting to this section?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Lloyd Thurman, District 10. I'm really kind of in agreement with Lady, what she said right here, of making sure that it's not even burdening the brand new chairman to be able to bring it in. Maybe 30 days would be applicable or whatever else, but my real concern is one additional thing. As I understood what she was saying in it was the financial responsibility. One of my concern is like Russ's situation here, of the possibility of there being financial burdens being placed upon him and responsibilities of which the old person who was the previous chair then could incur upon the new chair. And as I understand, already $100,000 have already been removed from the Alaska Republican Party, and there's shifting the money, should we say, that new chair is then going to be held liable for. So this is a portion of bringing this up, that person is accountable, you know, to maybe 30 days after whatever. That's the point.
Well, actually, somebody, you know, everybody needs to understand this. The Republican Party is not any individual, whether it be Randy or Russ. We have rules in effect, and they do govern this. If we need the forensic audit on what has happened with the $100,000 or anything else, we will have it done. I mean, not we, but the Republican Party will. So don't worry about this stuff. I mean, and really, if somebody has taken off with some funds, they will be accountable for it. And that also goes in the future. The rule that Randy and the others put in to keep him in power, this is a new rule. You know, when I first became a Republican back in 1972 or whatever it was, and a few fall into the AIP along the way, but nevertheless, you know, you did switch as soon as it was. So you have grief concerns, but it's because of this transition. Right. Incidentally, this is the third transition that I've seen like this movement. So this is not new. You guys, 5 years from now, will be seeing a new group come in for a new reason. And just don't worry about the money, because one thing about it, money has a trail. And it will be fall, so it'll be okay. So, all right, we're with that, give the microphone here.
Grace Jackson, District 25. I would just like to ask Russ Millett how he feels about this matter.
No comment. Okay. All right, and okay, so this one here, we still... Go ahead, Debbie. Do you want to comment on this portion of it?
Yes, Debbie Brown, District 30. I believe that the chairman should take place immediately. The chairman transition should take place immediately and handle the heaviness of the responsibilities with a lot of support. But I feel like I need to explain something here. Unless there are duties just put on paper to the chairman emeritus, or the outgoing chairman, from a practical point of view, there is no help. This is an unfriendly changeover. I suppose 5 years from now, like you stated, Jerry, it may be unfriendly, it may be friendly, but what they were trying to accomplish with a positive transition is absolutely not happening. So whether you have one day and you imagine some kind of a cheerful, you know, exchange going on, that I do not predict, unless you give some duties to that individual, the outgoing chairman, say these are the tasks that will be done in this transition. They're under no obligation to do anything, even though we might imagine it.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, very good point. And I don't want to be like a history buff, but when the moral majority took over the Republican Party here in Alaska, the same thing happened. When the Christian Coalition took over the Republican Party in Alaska, the same thing happened. When the Pat Buchanan Brigade took over the Republican Party, the same thing happened. A lot of people here, and by the way, not everybody here supports Ron Paul, you're taking over the Republican Party, the same thing is happening. That's the nature of the beast, and it will be okay. We don't really need to worry about it. And there's going to be somebody, thank goodness, there's going to be another group that comes along in 5 or 6 years, and they're going to take it all away from you and me. And that's okay. That's how the system works. It really is a good thing. And if you have a chairman that doesn't want to help the next chairman along, then shame on that guy. It's a good thing he's gone or she's gone anyway. So it's a very good procedure to have. And what you're doing, you're still leaving them in the room. They're just in a non-voting status. And that's what happens. That's what has always happened in the past. And it only happens when you have upheaval of people and you throw out the old guard. And that's what's going on right now. They're getting thrown out and they don't like it. But it's okay. You know, you're going to become the old guard and you're going to get thrown out. I know, a bunch of us in this room have been thrown out at time or two. Go ahead with the next one.
Okay, so the final one is to create regional chairman. Right now, we have regional representatives that are elected by the district chairman in their region, and we have regional finance chairmen that are appointed by the state chairman, approved by the SCC. So the regional finance chairman have a vote on the SCC, the regional representatives have a vote on the SEC, and they have to be members of the SCC also to hold that position. And to simplify everything and to make it work better, we're looking at just one position, regional vice chairman, that combines both of these, and it's elected by the SCC votes in that district, which would be district chairman bonus votes and any of the other ancillary positions of the SCC that may happen to live in that district. So they would vote on a regional vice chairman. It would be confirmed by the SCC, and so you'd end up with, right now, 7's the number, you'd end up with 7 of those. And you'd eliminate the appointed positions on the SCC, and they would have a vote on both SCC and SEC.
Okay, no objection to that one. What was the first one that was objected to? Let's go back and let's vote on it and get it out of the way.
This lady objects.
Oh, we have an objection on that. Take the microphone to the back of the room, please. I'm sorry, I didn't see anybody move or I wouldn't have heard it along like that.
I guess I need more explanation.
Name again, please.
Troy Cam, Carrollton, District 5. I guess I need more explanation from Lance on that one. I'm not sure. So you're eliminating the regional finance?
He's combining. They're combining it into one position. To be elected by the local people and confirmed by the central committee.
You're just renaming it.
Yes. Well, combining. Combining. There's two positions and combining them.
The essence is that you eliminate appointed positions.
Yeah.
And you end up with only elected positions, and only one person fills that role. He's elected by the people in his region.
And the main purpose is to weaken the chair's control of central committee.
I'm not saying that.
The purpose is not to weaken the chair, it's to increase the power of the elector.
Of the people.
Yes, okay, so that's microphone up front, please.
Well, just a question for the parliamentarian, so that you can find some.
Go ahead, wait, you get the microphone. Okay.
So the process is for the districts to elect the regional chair for their area to be confirmed by the central committee. What happens if the central committee does not confirm somebody?
If they don't get the votes at the central committee, then it goes back to the local and they re-nominate the same person or another one. I did that without notes. All right. Or without it. Okay. Okay, so we're through that one. Okay, let's go back to the what was it? I don't even remember, but I think we have three to vote on. Does anybody remember what the first one is, or can I just ask for unanimous consent?
District chairman, automatic delegate.
Was that, was the second one, wasn't it? It's the first one. Okay, and this gentleman up here brought up a point, and his point was is that some district people want to be a district chair, but they don't want to go to convention. So that's the whole thing. Are we going to save a slot for a district chair, even if they want to be a district chair, and they don't want to go to convention? That's the debate. No, that's not debate.
So let me read you the exact rule, the exact line we're putting in here. After it talks about electing delegates, okay. The district chairman shall, by virtue of the office, be entitled to be a delegate to the regular state convention, subject to their proper registration and payment of appropriate state convention fees. Now notice, he's entitled to be a delegate. He doesn't have to take that role, and there's nothing that there that gives him the ability to give that entitlement to somebody else. It's only by virtue of him being in that role that he is entitled to take that if he's able to and willing.
Point of clarification.
Go ahead, on the debate.
Along that line, if you could clarify this for me. So does that mean that officers in a district would automatically...
No, it means that the chairman would automatically be a delegate.
Only the chairman.
Only the chairman.
So the people still have a chance to be represented.
Absolutely.
Themselves.
Yes.
And they wouldn't be stuck.
That's correct. Under debate? Under debate, go ahead.
Or Thurman District 10, I'll say it again, it created tremendous problems in credentials. And if that chairman who is of that district, if he can't get the vote from the people, then what the heck to begin with? I mean, come on. So what we're doing is creating a problem here of a technicality problem into the future, which we already just went through a huge year that took up enormous amounts of time, which we didn't even get out of credentials until y'all finished. So just don't create the problem. Thank you.
Under debate, any future debate?
Yes.
Take the microphone. Take the microphone over, please. Name and district.
Lawrence Temple, District 12. So am I to understand that a seat would be automatically given to the committee chair, district committee chair, and that would take away from any slots for elected delegates, and alternate.
What do we, you're correct. What do we do? It'd make a one of the slots automatically to the chair.
It would take away from to be there.
Well, yes, it would, but also that person could decline it.
Yeah.
It wouldn't take away the slot if you didn't want to take advantage of that.
When do you find that out?
At the local level. Under debate, no speeches, debates. Then work our way back that way. Good.
Debbie Brown, District 30. If this were a motion, I would be speaking against it.
Okay.
I think there must be a rule somewhere in our platform that says Republicans don't believe in entitlements.
Okay.
All right. I think we should have them all elected, and that way everyone is equal.
So, I just want to point out that the district chair is elected. Nobody appoints the district, well, unless they don't elect a district chair. The district chair is elected, and therefore it's not like a non-elected person is becoming a delegate.
Robert Buchanan, District 21. Might I also point out that there are two ways you can become district chair. One is you become elected, the other is you become elected as vice chair, and then your district chair, for one reason or another, perhaps employment reasons, perhaps moves, death, whatever, is no longer district chair, and then you become district chair. So it's not necessarily the case, that's not necessarily the case that the person would be elected. If there are also cases where the reason why somebody becomes district chair is he's the only one who's dumb enough to take on the work, and or willing to do it, that doesn't necessarily mean that that person would be a good delegate. And I think linking those two is not necessarily a good idea.
Okay, on the debate, anybody else?
Lands on District 16.
Very loudly.
Lands on District 16. I was one of those people that almost knocked out the chairman. I'm the vice chairman for District 16 until they pulled some kind of shenanigans with credentialing somebody. I was the lead of my delegate, of the delegate for District 16. I earned that right as the vice chairman because my chairman was not elected a delegate.
That's right.
I've been taking hard on it. I went through a lot of crap with this that a lot of you guys know. And I stood on liberty when I did it.
The lady in the back room. I sure hope that we're not electing district chairman that we wouldn't consider to be good delegates also. I think that's a pretty important role. Name and district.
No. Trustee Fisher, District 11. I'd just like to point out that we elect them to be our district chair.
Hey, everybody. He's correct. Quiet, please. Go ahead, ma'am.
I think that if we can elect them to be our district chair, there's no reason they wouldn't be able to get elected to be delegates in the ordinary way.
Absolutely. Pretty good. We're about ready for the question. This young lady right here in the purple. The microphone's coming to you.
No.
Your name and district, please. Name and district.
Barbara Scrubel, District 18.
Thank you, Barbara. All right, is there a future debate under debate?
Okay, just before David Raw, District 9, just before we call the questions, which I think is about to happen.
Yes, it is.
For everybody to realize that the purpose of this was we had people at the convention who did not have a district chair present, and they needed help really bad. They were given no direction, they sought direction, they sought help, their district chair didn't come, and the purpose of this, theoretically, whether in the purpose that I was aware of, was to make it so that we encouraged the district chair to be a delegate to the state convention. Lots of people want to be the district chair, and then they just don't feel like going to the state convention. This at least encourages them to do so, to be there. I personally prefer the amendments did something in regards to the vice chair or someone that would lead the delegation. Hopefully that would be in that role to help them out. Thanks.
Under debate, is there anybody else who would like to speak to it? Thanks for bringing that up, David. I forgot about that. You know, when I was at the convention, I had to run down, leaving the Rules Committee two or three times to try and fix credentialing issues for my delegates, which ended up all getting fixed. But I was talking to credentials, which was a big pain because they didn't have a very good system for that, and trying to get a hold of my delegates to make sure things were taken care of. And so he's very right that the credentials need somebody to get a hold of, to get a hold of that delegate if they don't necessarily have the contact information and take care of the problem. And he may know about what payments were made in the district and any district level credentialing issues. And so that was part of the big reason why the Rules Committee went for this.
Okay, all those in favor.
Wait.
Oh, excuse me. I wasn't trying to rush along, but I was trying to move along. Give it to the right here.
Gene Brokaw, 25. Call the question.
Okay, the question's been called. Do you want? And we're going to vote, but you've been bouncing. Go ahead, gentlemen in the back room, and then I'll receive the question. What we're going to be voting on is whether or not the district chair becomes or has the option to automatically become a delegate. That's what we're voting on, yes or no. Okay, go ahead.
I'm seconding.
Oh, you're seconding.
I'll withdraw my.
All right, all those in favor of the district chair becoming a automatic delegate, if they do so desire, they signify by saying aye and raise a hand.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay and raise a hand.
Nay.
Okay, it failed. All right, next one. No, there was no objection to that one. Anybody, was there any other objections? That's why I allowed him to go ahead and speak if he wanted to, but they backed off. All right. What was the next one? The 3 days or 7 days? Is that correct? All right. Any discussion on a time frame for payment? Because there was a lot of confusion on it, a lot of problems with it. And what this is, it sets it down in writing where before it was up to interpretation. Is there any comments or questions on it before we vote? Look at this.
It's a person.
Okay. All right, where's the microphone? We got about 1, 2, 3, 4. Hands start that way.
Okay.
All right. And now, by the way, we're voting on this. If you want other, before we start, okay,
If you want something other than this, then save it and just vote no, okay? Because this is what it came up with, the time frame on payment. So we're not going to amend what they're doing right now. We're going to vote this up or down, and then we can go on to the next one instead of us having the debate, because my idea is completely different from this anyway, but at least this is in writing and it's better than what it was. Go ahead, Barbara.
Barbara Struble, District 18, no.
I love her.
Yeah, I do too. Go ahead, please, under debate.
Karen Perry, District 12, I was in credentials and I would say no.
Okay.
Because my reasoning is, it's up to the district chair, and if they drop the ball, somebody's going to get screwed, and we have Grace here today to witness to that.
Amen.
All right, and back to the room back there. That gentleman first. There you go.
Robert Buchanan, District 21. I think the time frames are incredibly short.
And
it's generally, every convention except for this one, you spend a lot of time trying to find enough people so you can fill a table. And so, 3 days, I mean, that's ridiculous. You just aren't going to be able to drum up delegates.
We used to be able to pay the day you came in, but go ahead, back in the room. That's not the motion.
Yeah, I know.
Ann Carlson, District 5. One of the things you're not looking at on this is the catering. When you could pay the day of the convention, did anybody run out of food this time? I don't know, but the credentials ran out of food because people weren't even registered, expected to arrive there on the day, pay, and then get fed. You can't cater something that way. You've got to have the money ahead, because once they pay their money, they may come. But if they don't, we don't get stuck with buying a lot of food.
The 3 of 7 day does it. Lady right in front of you under debate. Under debate, through the chair.
Tina Chapman, District 19. Being part of Rules Committee, I would just like to say that we went over this for a very long period of time. I promise you guys, every single one of these had a lot of blood, sweat, tears, fights, arguments, you name it. It was ugly. I would like to point out that on this one in particular, there are district conventions that run for, I think, the most Lance might know the dates, I don't know the exact dates. But what I understand is like the last district convention was just a few weeks before the state convention, or less than. It was a very short period of time. The other ones were months in advance. I know ours was in March, the first part of March. However, what we were talking about was having a standard of 3 to 7 after the convention, because they said that people need time to go through the paperwork, they need time to go and enter things, they need time to get the money so that they can pay for things, they can plan it out. What we suggested is that districts make an effort to give enough publicity prior to the district convention, stating very clearly, because like in ours, we were told right when we were like, oh, do you want to be a delegate? $250 right here, right now. And that is not accurate. Other people got worse things than that. The whole point with this was we wanted it something set. We wanted it set in writing. You guys can always modify it. You can always change it. That's not a problem. We wanted something set. That way we can tell people, hi, our district convention is going to be in 6 weeks. If you want to be a delegate, please make sure that you have arrangements to pay your state delegate fees of X amount. It will be due within 3 days or something of this date.
Thank you. Under debate, this lady right here, then we're going to move up front. Name and district, please.
Laura Wade, District 10. I don't really believe about the getting the money in advance for catering, because I paid my district or my state fees the day of my district convention. My check did not clear for 40 days.
Okay.
So, no.
Okay. Under debate, gentlemen, right up here. Take your microphone, please.
Bill Topol, District 25. I appreciate what the Rules Committee did on this, but I would argue for something more consistent, whatever that it would be. So right now I'd have to say no, but I appreciate the intent, and I agree with the intent, for obvious logistical reasons for delegates and alternates, as well as procuring the supplies.
Thank you. Under debate, lady right in front.
So I would speak in favor of the way this is written. This has to accomplish...
Lena District.
Oh, I'm sorry, Rebecca Logan, District 23. This has to accomplish two things. It has to give people the time to get the money together if they can't do it right at the convention. And it has to give the party the money to make a down payment. And so, to the person who just said your check didn't occur for 40 days, I just happened to know because I was involved with this, there were a significant amount of credit card deposits, so they had cash to make a deposit. This says that you have to make your payment 3 days after the adjournment of your district convention. Not everybody's district convention adjourns on the day it starts. So your district chair has the flexibility to work with people to give them more than 3 days from the first day. If you don't adjourn your district convention for another week or 2 weeks, people have more time to work with that. So I would speak to
Thank you. I did debate the lady right behind you. Name and district, please.
My name is Bernadette Rupright, District 9. And I agree with both positions. I think we need to set a date and a time specific, but I don't agree with the 3 days. Because most people, even if you announce the district meetings or you put it out before you have your district convention, they just aren't aware of it. I mean, people show up that haven't showed up to other meetings, et cetera. So 3 days is too short.
Thank you very much. Go ahead. Yes.
I think you're just... Can I call for the question?
No.
No?
No. We're not going to cut off debate. Go ahead, this gentleman here.
Andy Deering, District 34. I was just wondering if you could clarify on the... Read it one more time, please. And also, specifically, when the money has to get where. Is it 3 days that the check is written and dated, or is it 3 days when it actually arrives in its destination, or what?
Okay, so it says, registration fees for delegates shall be due to the district secretary within 3 calendar days of the adjournment of the district convention in which the delegate was elected, and registration fees for alternate delegates shall be due to the district secretary within 7 calendar days of the district convention with the alternate delegate elected. So that's the specifics, and then they have the other rules that cover when they have to send the paperwork in is 10 days. Do you need something more specific? Okay, so I wanted to address something that was brought just for the points of view that say it should be paid on the same day, which I was actually fine with. I tried to get that word out to my district, but I realized with redistricting, we didn't have good email lists for our district because we were working with new districts, which I hope never happens again. Okay, but in this case, contact didn't work as well because we didn't have emails for the active people in our district to let them know that they had to pay on the day, though I tried to get the word out as much as possible, and we did as best as we could.
Okay, go ahead.
Hi, Rita Black, District 33. I would say no on the way that it's written. I do think something along the lines of 2 weeks is probably your best bet because most people get paid twice a month, and it means a paycheck falls somewhere in there where they can square their stuff away.
Very good. Under debate, gentlemen behind you.
Steve Duby, District 13. Along the lines of Rita here, I would agree to a more extended period of time. However, I would add the wording to be all payments in whatever form necessary be due 30 days following the adjournment of the district convention or 30 days prior to the state convention, whichever comes sooner.
All right, those are all very good, but we're going to vote on it. We're going to vote this up or down. Gentlemen, right here. Because right now we're at 3 and 7 days, and we're going to vote right now. Go ahead.
Brett Cole. Brett Cole, 34.
Yes.
Taking into consideration remote district conventions.
Order. Go ahead.
Okay, so I was a precinct captain in Craig, and we had three convention locations. And so getting payment from to the treasurer in Haines from Craig in 3 days was being quite inconvenient for Sitka. So I would vote no on this. Okay. Specifically on top.
All right. Under debate, before we call the question, is there anybody else? And we're not anybody else on the 3 and 7 days. We're not amending this under this motion. Start in the back of the room, fellow in the blue shirt. Name and district.
Ron Windler, District 27. I'm opposed to this rule change. I have never seen the need for this kind of a thing. Every other convention that I've ever attended, and I've attended a number of them in different parties and different organizations, I've always been able to pay on the day of the convention. In order to be credentialed and let in, I have to pay my money.
All right. Microphone up here.
William Weatherby, District 36. It's a big district. It stretches down the Aleutian, the last peninsula ways, all the way up to Dillingham. We do allow a teleconference for our district convention. The idea of getting money from a village far away to the chairman in Dillingham, if that's where they're at, is ridiculous. 3 days, ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. I can't even believe people thought about this. They must have never been ambushed last year.
Okay. To speak, I can tell you right now, I already got a sense of where it's going, so now we're just talking to each other. Right, the gentleman back there first.
The reason that I believe that...
Name the district, please.
Oh, District 6, Dick Stump.
I know, Eric.
The reason that I believe that, the reason that they need so much money, they need the money up front, and there's so much of a pressure, is because they make this...
Quiet, please, in the room while the gentleman is speaking.
They make this into a fundraiser. You don't need to spend $250, and it's not done in any other place in the country.
Here, here.
And that's the main reason for this pressure to get the money, so much money up front.
Okay.
To make it into a fundraiser.
Thank you, Dick. Under debate, is there anybody else? A lady in the red right here, and then I believe we're ready for the question.
Yes.
Okay,
Name a district, please.
Laura Temple, District 12. I do stand in agreement with all of the reasons against the time frame. However, I will vote yes on that. This simply because I understand that we need to get the change made. Let's get this, as Tina was explaining earlier, let's just get this done, and then let's make the adjustments. But I would like somebody to fill me in as to how do we make the adjustment. Okay, so we'll say we vote yes, then how do we change the dates? At what point can we get the dates that are actually Alaskan reality?
The reason is this, we hand this to the new chairman, he takes it to the central committee, they have a discussion and they decide on it.
Okay, so then at least this would get this on the discussion table.
Yes.
And then they can fix it because he's listened to the people, he understands what the issues are. But if we vote no, it'll never get there.
That is correct.
Okay, so it's important to vote yes, even though we don't like the time frame.
That's your pick. Okay. All right. Any other people in the debate? Hearing none, I'm calling for the question. All those in favor of the 3 and 7 day limit, all those in favor, raise your hand and say aye. I'm going to let Russ speak for just a minute here until we figure out if we have any more to vote on.
Has Jerry been fair? Yeah. Have you all had a chance to express yourselves? That's what we want. Thank you, Jerry. I want to say one thing here. Officially, we've got 50 minutes before we have to vacate. Can we stretch it past that? I don't know.
We can extend.
Okay, we can extend one more hour if that hour is available. We'll have to go find out. And before we're finished, I wanted to put this in your mind that this all has to be paid for, okay? And this gentleman has to be paid for. So his money was upfronted by a very concerned constituent within this room. So we're going to take a collection before this is over. So loosen up your wallets and get ready. Thank you.
All right, so
let's ask him some more questions.
The report is that's why Debbie's vice chair. Okay, all right. This report, is there any objection to the approval of it other than the things that were not approved? If there is an objection, speak so. If not, I'm going to pass it. All right, it's approved. Okay.
Point of order.
Go ahead, you have the floor. 1 minute, please, to get the microphone, Barbara, and your district.
Barbara Scruble, District 18. I voted no on paid fees 3 and 7 calendar days, but I would like to have some deadlines there, not the 3 and 7, but we didn't talk about that. Can we do that or not?
Well, actually, let me tell you right now, that motion had failed, and when we get down to new business, because we are hitting there, we're going to get done with this meeting, and it ain't going to take 50 minutes. All right? Welcome to my world. We're moving along quickly here, and did you have any other items that we need to talk about other than this? Okay.
not discuss the term limit rules and debate that.
That was the one that I missed, wasn't it?
Yep.
Okay. Lance, term limits, and that was, there was an objection to it, was there? No, it was, okay.
Okay, so was there any objection to the district chairman and 30 days?
No.
No.
Okay.
What was the objection, Barb? What was the objection?
Okay, so the state one came to the Rules Committee where it happened immediately. The old chair becomes the state chair emeritus with a position on the SCC as a voting member. On the SCC is non-voting, and then the new state chair takes over immediately. All
right. Thank you. We've already approved that. That's done. I made a motion on that part. That's over with. So, now back to the original thing. Other than the things that were voted down, we're going to have to discuss with the chairman and the secretary and the other officers about time limits on it, because that's out of it. I accept a motion at this time, Jack, to approve those items in here that were not voted down.
So moved.
Jack Brown, that so moves.
Second, George Martin.
George Martin, is there any objection? No objections approved. Okay. Moving on to new business. We are done with old business. Is there any
resolutions?
I didn't see those.
That was the second thing I had on my
agenda. Where are they?
I don't know what.
Okay. Well, I need to have them in writing, and then I can just read them, and then we'll put them up or down.
They're on the table.
They're on the table. Where on the table? No, I'm in charge. I know that, but we actually need them. I don't think Evan has them all here either.
What?
Okay. I know I put resolutions in myself concerning the Second Amendment. I don't know what happened.
Who was on that committee?
Pardon?
Whoever was on that committee probably had.
Okay. Quiet, please, in the room. Anybody that put forth a resolution that wants it to be voted on in this time, please step forward.
We're going to start passing these buckets. A lot of people want to contribute and ask more from the audience. So we have to collect a significant amount of money. If you can't put any money in today, put a little note in that you'll do whatever. That'll be much appreciated. Just make sure there's a phone number on it so we can call it. Thank you very much.
Gene Brokaw. He's an honest man. He'll catch the checks to make sure he didn't pay. Gene, just let me say this. Gene wrote a check for $1,600 to get Mr. Merritt up here. Okay? It was in the interest of all of you that we do this, and that's why we did it. Does he have to get all his money back? We hope so, but if he doesn't, he can live with that. But give as much as you can, please. We also have to pay for this room, which is $50 an hour. We're into it now for $150, and if we go to $600, we're two. So there are expenses involved. Thank you for participating again.
Okay, so we, all right, the fundraising part, trying to chip some money in there. We're going to go to, are there anybody here that has some resolutions? If they are, come up here. Anybody that has any resolutions that are in this pile that want to vote it on now, because otherwise, this deck is about 40 of them, and we're not going through all of them unless that person is here. And so we don't necessarily have to speak for the whole committee. Hit the highlights. Name and district.
Rebecca Logan, District 23, and I chaired the Natural Resources Committee at the convention. These are the resolutions that all that were passed our committee. Grounds for recall of elected officials, which says, now therefore be resolved that, it says, whereas we hold our elected officials to strict adherence of Article 8 of the Alaska Constitution, therefore be resolved that failure to obey this will be grounds for removal from office by recall process. Number two, all Alaska gas pipeline, whereas natural gas is the greatest unused resource in the state of Alaska, therefore be it resolved that the Republican Party respectfully requests the state legislature support an all Alaska gas pipeline development along the Taps Richardson corridor to utilize North Slope gas. Rejection of National Defense Preparation Executive Order. I think people here are pretty familiar with that, so I'm not going to read through that whole thing. Senate bipartisan coalition. Whereas the formation of the coalition gave Democrats control of the Senate, now therefore be resolved that the Alaska Republican Party will withhold all future campaign funds from senators who join the coalition. government fees for accessibility to public lands, whereas much of the public lands are inaccessible to the public except by commercial operators, now therefore be it resolved that commercial operators should be exempt from government fees for providing access to those lands that would not otherwise be accessible to the public. Land disposal program, whereas the state of Alaska has a limited land disposal program, and whereas the state land available for commercial use is limited, now therefore be it resolved that the party strongly urges the State Division of Land Management to adopt a land disposal program patterned after the old federal trade and manufacturing site program. And our final one was a resolution relating to state oil taxes. Therefore be resolved, and it's a long thing if people want to see it, that the party respectfully requests the Alaska State Legislature support the Parnell administration's efforts to pass legislation resulting in reform intended to spur investment in our oil fields, thereby reversing the economically ruinous decline in TAP's throughput. Those are the ones that passed our committee.
Is there an objection to adopting any of those resolutions from that committee? Is there any objection? Which one, microphone to him, which one do you object to?
I would object to Brent Cole 34. I would object to the coalition.
Okay, coalition one objects. Is there any objections to any of the other ones? I accept a motion to adopt all the other ones with the exception of the coalition one.
Bill Cole, District 45, I was on that committee, and he's an alternate. I do make that motion.
Second. Okay, they're all approved other than the coalition one. Discussion on. Declining funds to Republican candidates that join a coalition. Any discussion on it? Microphone back here to this gentleman first.
Brent Cole, 34. My objection on that would be what we're all against right now, which is party politics, because our mentor in our quest for liberty, Dr. Paul, has built coalitions, one specifically the end of the or out of the Fed. And so I think we should put our money where our mouth is on principle rather than on party politics.
Okay, under debate, the gentleman right over here, and then we'll go to the back of the room. Right, no, right here, this gentleman first. This is our funding to,
okay.
Legislators to join coalitions.
Justin Caro, District 33. We talked about this forever in Natural Resources Committee, and there was a lot of stuff covered with it. We talked about a variety of ways of addressing it, and the problem boils down to this. As a party, if we're going to support candidates and get them elected to represent the planks in the party, then they need to at least not vote against them. Okay, I can understand that someone can't support a bill, there's something not right about it, but then they need to go take a leak, smoke a cigarette, or do something else. But to specifically vote against something that's in the planks, I don't think is appropriate considering the efforts that the party goes through to help get these people elected in the first place. I mean, we're sending them to do a mission. They should be able to do the things that we direct them to.
All right, under debate, and what if I understand this, and I do, we're asking to withhold funds from elected Republicans that form a coalition.
With the Democrats,
which we might as well clarify, because I've been elected to the State House and to the State Senate. Is there anybody else in here that has served in the State House or State Senate? Okay, I would like you to know, when I was elected to the State House, I formed with the Democrats. We had 23 Republicans, and we brought in 6 Democrats. Okay, so there could be a little problem there, because we brought in the Bush ones so that we'd have a supermajority to have 27 votes. When I was in the Senate, we brought in Jerry Mackey and Dave Donnelly, who were both Democrats, who later switched to Republicans. But we brought them in, and we had 11 votes because we wanted to get to 2/3. So there was a 10-10, and we brought in George Jacko as a Democrat so that we'd have 11 votes. Everybody knows that, so I just want you to know there are a few technical problems with this. Back to the room, and then we'll go on from there.
I just want to clarify that our resolution says people who joined this coalition this past time that gave control to the Democrats.
Right.
It's very specific about
Oh, okay.
That's what it currently says.
So what this resolution is saying, don't give money to those Republicans that joined with the Democrats this last time.
That resulted in the Democratic majority.
Okay, very good. All right, I didn't quite understand that. because it's very hard not to bring... Yeah, if you could, Rebecca, where is it? Lance ran away and I'll read it.
You're on my...
Point. Okay, that was the wrong one. Okay, let me just summarize it then so that I misunderstood. I misunderstood. Okay. Therefore, be it resolved, the Alaska Republican Party will withhold all future campaign funds from the senators who join the coalition.
But above that, it says, talks about them being senators
who gave... No. Everybody understands what we're talking about. We're talking about the existing Republican senators that join the coalition and to withhold funds from them. All right? Are you ready for the question or do we want to debate some more? This is really easy. Back here with the microphone first.
Robert Buchanan, District 21. My state senator, who is kind of an embarrassment, is one of those state senators. If you look at her voting record, she votes like a Democrat. She gets her money from the same places that Democrats do. Her dad's a pretty good Republican. It's not a fault of breeding. But she, you know, I'm sure it's not her right. But she is basically only a Republican because her dad is a Republican. And she's a disaster. And it's very hard to remove her. We have one guy here who's running against her. And I would hate to see any Republican dollars, any money that I'm not going to give money to the Republican Party that might go to support her. Because she's, if you vote for her, you're voting for a Democrat.
All right, under debate, under the specific language here, under debate, anybody out before I call for the question? Yes, this gentleman over here.
Mark Hanksmith, District 38. I'd like to clarify the parliamentary situation on the vote. And I vote supports the plank as written, which would deny the funds to those Republicans who joined the Democrat coalition.
That is correct. That is what's going to happen. I'll clarify just before I call for the question. We got a few more people that want to speak back in the room. She's taking longer and longer to get the microphone around.
I was just going to say that if they're getting money from typical Democratic sources, they shouldn't be getting money from the Republican Party as well. You can, if you on principle agree with these people, you can give to their campaigns individually, but the party itself should not be giving to Republicans who are voting as Democrats and taking money from Democrats.
Thank you. Under debate, anybody else? This gentleman up front, microphone's coming.
I'd like to
name and district.
Bill Tolman, District 25. Hopefully this is worded so that we're not giving money away to Republicans who have the effect of producing a Democratic majority. This would not prevent coalitions on certain issues like poverty. Yeah, if this is written like that.
Now that I've read it, it's written quite clearly. The lady behind you, no, hand the dirt, right, five rows back. Go ahead, please. Dean District.
Karen Perry, District 12. I'd like clarification. Are we talking about at the state level, federal level, or both?
State level.
Thank you.
Anybody else in the debate before I call the question, and then I'll restate the question one more time, and then I'm going to call for it. And if you vote aye, then you're in favor of withdrawing any funds from the Republicans that joined the state Senate and made the Democrats in the majority. Okay. All those in favor of withdrawing funds from the Republicans that joined the Democratic coalition under the current state Senate, signify by saying aye and raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed, say nay and raise your hand. Yes, point of order, please. Go ahead.
While you read that, can I just make sure that everybody has signed this tablet? And if you have not, please put your hand up so I can get there. So I have an accurate count of names and districts of people that attended.
Okay, back there. They haven't signed it. Okay, read your resolution and the new business.
Okay,
Okay, this is, my name is Andy here in District 34. I have a resolution here to the Constitution platform. It means, whereas it is unclear in the Alaska State Constitution, Article 11, Section 8, as to the ability of the people to recall their elected federal congressional delegation, whereas current interpretation of Article 11, Section 8, by state statute, does not allow initiation of the recall process for federal congressional delegation. Whereas the United States Congress has failed in its duties to censure or remove from office its members found negligent in their oath of office to support and defend the Constitution of the United States, be it resolved that we, the Republican Party of Alaska, support amending the existing language in Article 11, Section 8 of the Alaska State Constitution to clearly and unequivocally empower the citizens of Alaska to exercise recall of their federal congressional delegation.
Amen!
Is there a second? Their elected legislators on federal level, please signify by saying aye and raising your hand.
Aye!
All those opposed, nay and raise your hand. Okay, any other resolution that are new business? Sir, hey, by the way, if you have a new business, get up in line so that because we're trying to move this along and be very quick about it. Please, no discussion because we're actually in the time frame here, and so if you could keep the voices down into this, we'll move along quickly.
This one actually passed, Jack Brown, District 30. This one actually passed our committee, Rebecca, but I think it got dropped someplace. And it's simply, whereas the Alaska Republican Party does not support the creation of DNR's special use area.
Is there a second for it? There is no second?
I second.
Okay, the second name?
George Martin, 29.
All right, and is there a discussion on it before we vote? Okay, sponsor wants it.
I know what it is.
Hey, basically what DNR is doing, and if you haven't had the great opportunity like we have of having these Nazis come into your community and restrict local residents from attending places they've been for 30, 40, 50 years, putting fees and unused restrictions on local property owners like us, welcome to our world. In addition to that, this is not known by the general public, but DNR wants to create a separate enforcement agency with DNR employees going around with the same enforcement powers as the troopers and the wildlife people. This is an expansion of government. And it's huge. They're doing it in small areas to start off with, and it's a statewide effort, so I would appreciate your support in this.
If anybody's familiar with RS-2477, what he's talking about is where the state has now crept back in and taken those rights away to access. Okay, if there's no more debate on it, I'll call for the question. Can you take the microphone over here, please?
Oh, yep. Connections. There's entanglement with this also with Agenda 21.
Exactly.
For those of you who know it better.
And anybody that has followed the land use up here, go ahead, under debate, gentlemen, sir.
Steve Dewey, District 13, a member of the Natural Resources Committee.
Okay, please, could everybody be respectful and give the person that is speaking a chance to speak? Your name and district again, please.
Steve Dewey, District 13.
Continue.
As a member of the Natural Resources Committee, I rise in full support of this resolution. It pretty well coincides with a lot of the spirit that we went through in determining a lot of our platform. So,
thank you. Is there anybody else under debate, under discussion debate? If not, I call for the question. All those in favor of the resolution.
at District 19. This was a resolution that was passed in Health Committee during the...
Louder!
Can you hear me now? This was, my name is Dirk Moffitt, District 19. This was passed in the Health Committee, and it didn't get listened to, but...
Can you hear me now? He lost a resolution. Are you ready? Can I take her next while you find it? Come along up here. Is there any other resolutions? Is there any other? You're up. You're the only one left, and we're going to be done. Okay, he's got to go to his wife now and find it. It was a very good one. It was a very good one.
Not his wife.
Oh, not his wife.
This is a resolution to censure Lisa Markowski.
Okay, if we can have quiet in here, please let's be respectful of the people that have bothered to come up and take the floor. You have
it? Here.
Okay, not his wife. Could you come back up and fix his friend? All right. And this is the last resolution. Is that good? There are no other resolutions on the new business. All right, we're almost done here. So. Okay, they're pushing a button. They're finding it.
Let her read it.
Let her read it. Okay, if you find it, will you read it?
Jerry, don't bump anybody. You're probably bumping the phone.
I'm probably causing this to happen. I'm sure that I am. Okay. Okay, don't touch them. I'm holding my mic to your face.
Whereas Lisa Murkowski has showed a special contempt for the Alaska Republican Party electorate by expressly promising and subsequently breaking her word to support the winner of the 2010 Alaska Republican primary election for U.S. Senate. And whereas she sought re-election in 2010 as an independent writing after losing the Republican primary, and whereas she actively campaigned against and maliciously attacked the Republican nominee, and whereas she has aligned herself with the AFL-CIO, NEA, Planned Parenthood, Public Employees Union, and other Democratic special interest groups, and whereas support for these far-left-wing special interest groups cannot be reconciled with the ideals and values of the Alaska Republican Party, nor with the best interests of the people of Alaska, and whereas during 2010 general election, Lisa Murkowski demonstrated dishonesty, duplicity, and not in keeping with Republican Party values, and whereas the actions exhibit an extraordinary disloyalty to the Alaska Republican Party and the electorate, without which her career and as elected official would never have been possible, and whereas Senator Lisa Murkowski was the only Republican to vote for every major piece of President Barack Obama's 2010 lame duck agenda, and whereas she has subsequently obstructed Republican attempts to reform and supported numerous policies, positions opposed to the Alaska Republican Party platform. Therefore, it be resolved that we, the delegates of the 2012 Alaskan Republican State Convention, publicly censure, repudiate the words and actions of our Senator Lisa Murkowski and revoke her Republican privileges until she publicly apologizes and pledges to never campaign against the Republican nominee again and ceases and desists supporting parts of the President Obama's agenda that are in... Yeah, Republican values.
Not really.
And platforms. So that's basically it.
All right, is there a second?
Second!
Name and district.
Rita Black, District 33.
Okay.
Jeff Milton, District 31. Forget what district I'm in. While I disagree with what Senator Murkowski did, I think a censure of this nature is very bad performance. And I think it could hurt us a whole lot more than it could ever benefit this group.
Under debate, gentlemen in front.
Richard Kohler, District 14. I'm in agreement with everything until it gets to the penalties. I think that we should just state our opinion and avoid any penalty.
We're voting on the motion as it was read. I
committee.
Upfront.
Tracy Talbot, District 7. I was also on the Health and Education Committee,
And there were people that opposed it, worried about what it would look like publicly. And we felt that she did this to the Republican Party publicly, and that it was fair for her to know that we do not stand for the things that she stands for. And we felt that she needed to know publicly how we felt.
Under debate, anybody else before we call for the question? Go ahead.
Rita Flagg, District 33. As I took time to research, one of the things I found very impressive is that there are 20 Democrat senators that are more conservative than Lisa Murkowski right now in their voting records.
Okay. Wait, Kevin, before you do that, where's the gentleman that made the motion? Okay, we need a friendly amendment to change it from the Republican Party to the name of this organization.
Committee.
Okay, somebody move.
So move.
Who is it?
Justin Caro, District 33.
Okay, so the motion, we've removed it from. Okay, you got it. All right, seconded by. Got that? Okay. Under discussion, Debbie.
Thank you, Debbie Brown, District 30. I really think this needs to be said. I think that we need to make it, it is written very well, very strong. There's one word that I'm not sure what it means to anyone. I mean, I would like to see the word censure removed. I would like to make that amendment because I think it's an undefined.
Are you making a motion to remove that?
I would like to remove that one word.
Is there any objection to removing the word censure?
But everything else remains. And censure, meaning we don't want her to do business for us in Congress?
Yes.
Is that what I just would. I'm going to make that motion to remove that word because I don't really think she would even be able to apologize if we said.
Wait, one minute, please. The parliamentarian would like to have the floor to explain what the word censure means.
Thank you.
And that may remove your objection.
Don't second it until we get this.
Parliamentary speaking. Censure just expresses displeasure. It does nothing else. It does not remove anyone's. It doesn't remove anyone from office. It doesn't do anything except express. If it's adopted, it expresses this group's displeasure with actions. That's all it does.
Thank you very much. I would like to withdraw my concern.
Okay. So, any other comments on the debate before I call for the question? Back to the room and microphone to that gentleman. I remember that name.
Hello, Robert Ken, District 21. I would like to remind the assembled people here that whether we censure Lisa Murkowski or do anything to her, she's going to be our senator for another 4 years. There's nothing, unfortunately, I might add, there's nothing that we can do about it. And the list of her offenses, so to speak, actually omits a few things. One of the ones I would like to point out is she attempted to join another political party.
Right.
Which had the good taste to reject her. imagine what will happen if she decides to change to Democrat, like next month. Her votes wouldn't change, I'm sure. However, that would be one more Democrat organizing with the Democrats in the Senate for 4 years, and we couldn't do anything about it.
I think the
thing that we need to do is go after her in a couple of years.
Okay, thank you. Under debate, this gentleman here.
My point for this gentleman here is that we just passed a resolution stating that we should be able to recall it.
Yeah.
Okay. Under debate, before I call for the question, is there anybody else that would like to speak under debate? Go ahead, please. Well, you made the motion. Yeah, go ahead. Name it.
Yeah, what I want to say.
Name the district, please.
My name is Dirk Moffitt, District 19. And one of the arguments that I made is, one of the things I've heard a lot during the convention, and even here, is this belly aching about the bipartisan working Senate group down in Juneau. And if we don't hold Lisa Murkowski accountable for what she did, then we can't hold them accountable for what they did. And so I would leave it with that, that if we do not censure, or we do not show our displeasure, I mean, we pretty much did show our displeasure at the convention. But in a more legal document, show our displeasure with her. I don't think we have any leg to stand on it when it comes to the bipartisan working group that's working in Juneau with the Democrats.
Thank you. Okay, seeing no other debate, I'm going to call. Okay, very back. Hold on a second. Get to the microphone.
Point of order. I asked that
the amendment be
Richard Kohler, 14. I asked early on that the censure be accepted except for the penalties be reduced, and then I was told that that can't be, and somebody else made a motion to remove the word, and you accepted removing the word. So I'd just like to reinforce. But you did accept the motion.
I said,
well, I'd just like to reiterate that I would like to have the censure approved, but remove the consequences. The consequences are well, if I can make a motion, I'll move it.
You're welcome to right now, unless you'd like to amend the motion, we're going to vote on this, and then if you would like to do some further, make an additional motion.
Sure, I'd love to amend the motion to just include the first part of Dirk's statement that requires the censure and our displeasure and all of the whereas, and remove the penalties, because I think that by having the penalties in there, we're looking like we're
damn it.
Whereas we're just describing our censure or desires at having us.
Thank you.
All right. By the way, just so that everybody knows, the penalties are flowery words. They cannot be imposed. So whether they're there or not, it just shows displeasure and disdain for what she's done. They can't be imposed upon her. So whether they're there or not, it actually really makes no difference. It does show disdain for what she's done. But as far as removing them, they have no consequences to a federal elected senator.
Period.
Okay. All right. Okay.
That was a motion to...
You made a motion to amend... Okay, motion to amend. All those in favor of amending Dirk's motion and stopping and removing the penalties signify by saying aye and raise your hand. Point of order? No, under debate. Under debate. No point of order.
Second.
Second? I'll second.
Yeah, I seconded
it. Okay. Grace Jackson, District
25. Okay, under debate to remove the sanctions. Under debate, anybody want to speak to that before we vote? Okay, all those in favor of removing the sanctions and leaving the first part of it without the sanctions, signify by saying aye and raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed, signify by saying nay and raise your hand.
Nay.
Okay, it is now before us. All those in favor of passing the George, could you give the microphone name, please? Name and district?
George Martin, District 29. I just want to make a point of information. I fully support this motion. She needs to have our displeasure. But the chances of it passing the do-gooders and the rhinos in the SCC, and I'm a member of the SEC, not one of those. It's pretty remote. But I just want everybody to be aware of that. This is something we want to have the SEC pass, but I don't think there's a snowball chance of that.
All right, so noted. Okay, calling for the question. All those in favor of the resolution as presented, signify by saying aye and raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed, signify by saying nay and raise your hand.
Nay.
Okay, the ayes have it, it's passed. No further resolutions here, we're done with new bit. Microphone, please, name and district.
Bill Tobel, District 25, request for information. Did we consider today a resolution to repeal Section 1021 of the National Defense Authorization Act?
Yes, I think we did that.
We did that. I didn't even hear a vote today.
We approved it.
Okay, good.
We did. Okay, I might have brushed over it quickly, but we did. Okay, microphone, please. We're about to wrap this up. Go ahead.
So I would just like to make a motion that the items that were dealt with here today be forwarded to the Central Committee without the recommendation of this group, but it's the sense of this body that these things be passed by the Central Committee as we have forwarded them.
Is there a second to the motion? Okay, all those in favor of forwarding the actions that we've taken today to the Central Committee of the Republican Party of Alaska, signify by saying yes, raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay, and raise your hand. Okay, the ayes have it. All right, so we're, yes, sir, because we're still under new business now.
down, then we're moving very quickly down the road here. Name a district, please.
Sean Godfrey, District 23. This would be new business in terms of censoring in light of recent events. There are some other individuals that I would like to introduce for censoring that this body. That would include all party officers that did not attend today without showing good cause be censured.
Okay, if I might, could you reduce that to writing? I know what you're trying to get at, but you're going to have to reduce it to writing, if you would, please. And we'll move along when we can come back and open it up. Unless you want to vote on it now.
Yeah.
What he's asking to do is to censure the people that didn't show up today.
How about the one that showed up?
Yeah.
Include him.
Okay, Mr. Chairman. Okay, I've got your motion. Anybody want to second his motion? Because his motion was to censure the people that did not show up today.
Mr. Chairman, let me
interrupt.
My motion is to censure anybody who did not sign in without good cause, and also to censure any candidates that spoke, were seated delegates, and did not sign in.
Is there a second?
I'll second. Daryl Lands on District
16. Name a district.
Daryl Lands on District 16.
Okay, we're going to, I would tell you right now, we're probably going to have somebody amend that because it's going to have to be more specific. It's a very general motion. All right. Microphone over here.
Point of order, I think it does need to be in writing.
Yeah, it does. Sir, could you step over here with him and the two of you reduce it down to a resolution and try not to shoot everybody in the world.
Okay.
Yeah, but and there's nothing wrong with it. With, you know, calling people out for what they've done, but you know, you should use a bullet, not a shotgun. Okay. Is there any other new business to come before? We are going to go back and open up for his resolution. Somebody needs to get with this gentleman right here and write it out, okay? What is your new business? No, sir. Okay, on the new business, what is it?
I would like to give some information. My name is Barbara Anderson, and District 28, thank you. There is a lot of talk all of the time amongst all of us about the injustices that we've received. And everyone is always saying after their conversation, and I hear their head go to the left or right, we've got to do something. We've got to get a lawyer. Who's got a lawyer? What are we going to do? If you really are seriously interested and you'd like to know, I do have information for you. There's an organization called Tools for Justice, and I've spoken with them on the phone. And I reiterated to them that I know that we have probably between 40 and 60 documented grievances. And what they have put together is there is a team of lawyers, or there's a lawyer designated for our state if we so desire. And we do have some people who have already filed grievances. This is going to be a federal case if... You know your limitations and you know how far you can go. If you really feel that your civil liberties have been
thwarted.
Yes, I mean through any way, and have intimidated you or coerced you into not exercising your full right to be an American citizen and participate in the delegating process or being a delegate or the voting process, or if you've witnessed anything like that, these people are serious and they are wanting to file on Monday. They're wanting to get to me. It's going to be
they filed yesterday.
Through a Ninth Circuit court judge. Is that, I don't know.
No, they filed yesterday.
Okay, well, I don't know that much, but I do know that it is real, and you have to really decide whether you have felt like you've been personally objected or not. What they will do is they'll take your testimony, they'll review it, and they'll give you the information that you need, and they will submit an affidavit for you, and there are other states involved in this, and this is nationwide. So if you want that information, I can get that for you. Toolsforjustice.com.
Instead of going to toolsforjustice.com, she's going to be standing right over here at the end of the meeting. I'm going to talk to her, because what they actually will need is contact names to take a deposition. Please keep the voices down. We're coming to the end of the meeting, and we're under new business. Under new business, is there any item under new business?
Where do you want me to go?
I have a point of information on that topic.
No. Just go to her.
I have a point of information about it. The lawsuit was filed yesterday. I'm one of the plaintiffs. I would like to speak to this, please.
Okay. Microphone, please.
I don't need the microphone, trust me.
Okay.
They did a lot to me. I know a lot of you know this. Okay? All of you stand to be a plaintiff in this. Understand and listen to what I'm saying. Everybody that sat on that convention floor had their civil rights violated. Everybody that sat on that convention floor had their voting rights violated. This has been filed under federal law. It's a federal class action lawsuit filed under the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. All of you are legitimate plaintiffs. Maybe not all of you recorded them screwing you in the credentials committee, but you all have grievances. You are all intimidated. It is valid. All you need to do at this point is go on that website, register, go under the forums, go down to Alaska Personal Testimony, put in your district, put in your information, and say, I want to be a party to this lawsuit. I am working on my testimony. It's that simple at this point. We are all have all been served a grave, grave injustice.
So if I may, to clarify my statement, talk to Barbara or him, either one.
You just need to go to Tools for Justice. You don't need me. Tools for Justice is easy to remember.
So two of you stay afterwards so we have discussions. Microphone here, before we're going to close down your business.
I would like to make a motion to find out if this body believes this is valid. What I'd like to see us do, and here's the motion, that if our central committee or executive committee refuse to handle the resolutions and the matters that we are going to forward to them, if they disregard what we're sending to them, I would like to move that we, from our own committee, send this information, these messages to them in the form, whatever they are, platform, resolution, all to our governor, our legislators, every appropriate level of government, to our elected officials, so that they know what our committee is wanting done.
It's a very good motion. If you could just amend it to give me the right to appoint three people to approve the finished minutes afterwards, because we're not going to have another meeting.
Very well. Well, I'm sure.
I know. I'm just going to get it in now before everybody.
Three people, I believe.
I nominate Deborah Brown.
If Rebecca Logan would be willing, because a great deal of the matter was natural resources, Rebecca. So Rebecca agrees. I myself will.
Yeah, you're an officer.
Oh, I'm not.
You're an officer. I'd like to not have officers.
And I'm making the motion, so yeah. I will do it. Two hands. Who would join? Dave McGraw. Dave McGraw, are you willing? There we are, Dave.
Okay,
Dave.
And one more person.
And one more, looking. Raise your hand. Evan Cutler.
I nominate Evan because he's not here.
Evan
Cutler. All right.
Very well.
Okay, those three, and the reason that I had a minute, what do you guys ask for the action of today to be given to the governor and all of our elected people that we can find, as well as the national and to the central committee? She has amended it because what we need is a three-person committee to approve the minutes, because we're not going to have another meeting. And you just stated the names.
Rebecca, Dave McGraw, and Evan Cutler.
All right. Beautiful motion. We rolled it all in one day. Seconded by George Martin, District
29.
Is there any objection to the motion?
Yeah. I would like to offer friendly amendment.
Friendly amendment?
If we could include
microphone,
the media.
Please.
If we could include the media as well in that list.
Very well.
Other than the one that's here. As you stated, I want to commend
you. It's done. Okay. All right. There's no second. The motion is on the floor to approve Debbie Brown's motion to distribute this to the central committee, also to create a three-member committee. signify by saying aye and raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed signify by saying nay and raise your hand.
Nay.
Okay, it's approved. With that, yes, under new business still.
Law firm in District 10, I just wanted to recognize those people who come from such a long distance at such a grave amount of expense. Yeah.
Is there a second?
Second, Daryl Lance on District 16.
Okay, it's been motion is moved. A second discussion. Okay. All those in favor signify by aye. I was moving along so quickly. Yes, go ahead. Under discussion right here. Name a district.
Wall District 28. And my only question is if we wait that long before payment and a delegate screws up, doesn't, you know, decides not to go or whatever, and doesn't make the payment, will that still leave enough time for the alternate to give the money in?
15 days.
Yeah,
have you
been
in already?
Yeah. And delegates pay at the same time.
This gives an alternate more time to get.
All right. So there's enough time to go through the list and make sure.
All right. Anything other than discussion? Under discussion, the motion has been moved and seconded under debate. Go ahead.
I just want to
microphone, please.
I'm sorry, Justin Caro, District 33. I just want to reiterate that I think the people should be able to pay at the convention no matter what.
Okay, that's not the motion before us. But I agree. Go ahead. Under debate, gentlemen back here.
Adam Gover, District 11. I don't think that would work. Our district convention was 32 or 33 days prior to the state convention. That would give us no time, hardly.
Okay, under debate, gentlemen right here, and then over to this lady right here. Under debate.
Friendly modification. Point of information, Steve Doobie, District 13. Can we make a motion to the amendment, or make amendments to the motion?
Yes, you can make amendments to the motion, but why don't you talk to her? She's about to amend her own motion. If you scurry right on over here, that'll be great. Okay, under debate. Anybody else under debate? If not, if you can bring the microphone, go ahead.
I just want to say on the debate, what's in Paulette's mattress? We're worried about the party not having money. $100,000 disappeared. That was plenty to cover the expenses of the convention. That was a down payment, legitimately. I'm standing with Justin on this. There's no reason. I paid mine enough for PPP. I wanted to get the stuff taken care of. But there's no reason that the Republican Party didn't have the money to cover it.
If you can bring the microphone over here, they're going to amend the motion. And I would, once we're done with this motion, if there's business, come here.
Did you see the thing I posted?
Okay, we're going to have time after I adjourn this, but I need to adjourn it so that I can hand it back over to Russ. Okay, hold on while they're making the
amendment. Thank you, Jerry. Okay, how many of you want to stay till 6? How many want an extension till 6? Raise your hand. Well, we have it if we want it, but it's 5 o'clock now, so.
Let's go home.
All right.
Yeah.
Don't get lost in the chance, that's fine. But listen, please, and you're going to get to make your motion. You are. We've collected $1,180. We'll soup about $800. If we can come up with that, a portion of it, it would certainly be appreciated to show a thank you for those in front of the money. I'm going to pass these buckets again. Feel free to put in whatever you want or not whatever you want. We're always putting any pressure on anybody, but we do have expenses. So thank you for your participation.
Okay, now the amending the motion. Go ahead.
Yeah, when I get my refund.
Elected district delegates and alternate alternates must have convention fees into their district chairperson either 10 days
after the convention is, their district convention is adjourned, or no later than 30 days prior to the state convention, whichever is later. And the district chairperson to the state RPA no later than 14 calendar days prior to the state convention.
Okay, she's amended her motion. I don't believe it takes a second to approve an amendment. Is there objection to her amending the motion? There's objection? Microphone, please.
We could throw in Paulette Simpson, Captain.
The concept I don't object to, but I'll tell you what. Ever since third and fourth grade, most of us do not like word problems. And this constitutes a very interesting word problem that people are not going to have the patience for. I think you're, whoever had that original idea of just, you know, one date, like no later than.
Yes.
I would go for something like that, but all of this other stuff, absolutely not.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Are you withdrawing your motion?
No.
Okay, so just any conversation or debate on the motion. Back to the room first with the microphone. Back to the room first. Okay? And then we'll come up for action. Okay, the motion is as amended. We're under debate. Name district.
Bethany Markham, District 24. Any date other than the day of the convention potentially disenfranchises a district. For example, in our district, we had district delegates who did not show. The alternates were moved up. We still had alternate spots. We had actual spots in the district that weren't filled because they hadn't registered in advance, and so we didn't have our full number of delegates who could vote. So you could potentially lose votes in your district by not allowing registration clear up till the day of the convention. We had people who were willing to come, but they were not allowed to register.
Very good. This microphone up front, please. Under debate, the motion that's before us. Either one, or they're moving both of them.
I just want to make sure
that
we're giving out good information with regard to this motion. $100,000 didn't disappear, and it couldn't have been used to front any money for the convention. It was the House majority. It was the House fund and the Senate Challenger fund, and the monies in those funds were designated by the donors. And there was nobody has the authority to use any of that money to front anything. It can only be used for the purpose for which it was raised.
Okay, the lady right behind you.
Speaking to the motion, my name is Bernadette McBride, District 9. I think a good solution to this is to have 50% of the elected delegates and alternates fees due in a reasonable amount of time at a set specific date, and the rest to be eligible to sign in, you know, because people have problems and things happen right at the date of the convention.
Okay, that is not the motion. Okay. Under debate under this motion, before we vote, anybody else want to speak on it before I call for the questions? Go ahead, please. Yes, lady right there.
Karen Perry, District 12, and again, I was in credentials, and this is where we ran into a lot of problems. Now, if you have payment on election or convention day, there are issues with people's checks not clearing or funds being in a debit account, and so that can be a problem. But the thing with, like Debbie said, all these other different days threw credentials into loopholes. So it's either one day, the day of the convention, and keep it simple.
Okay, the motion is before us. Anybody else before we call for the question? Gentleman in the back of the room, Mr. Buchanan.
Robert Buchanan, District 21. I also would like to agree it should be the day of the convention. I can tell you, I live in Anchorage. It took me a week and a half to run down my district chair because he was busy.
Microphone up, please.
So it took me a week and a half to run down my district chair, and I couldn't, and I eventually went down to the party of the state party office and hid there. He was busy. Our schedules didn't overlap. If somebody lives in a little village, and, you know, it may not be easy to get the check or whatever to their district chair. I think we know that if they're coming to the convention, they'll be at the convention. I think all these rules about trying to get the money earlier, if you want the money earlier,
okay.
have the party chair,
all right,
the district chairs, and have them drum up the money.
Okay. So, I need to find out something. Do you now want to withdraw your motion and make a new motion, or you want to vote on this? Yeah, no. Do you want to amend your motion? See, what we're doing is we're amending this thing going along here, and that's not what we're going to do.
I'll vote for the question, please.
Okay, all those in favor.
I'd like to amend my motion.
You'd like to make the motion.
Amend the motion.
Yes, amend the motion.
possible?
Just go ahead and give them.
Let's do that. Flat 15 days before the start of the convention.
State convention?
Yes, 15 calendar
days. Okay, she's amended it to where the money would be due 15 days before the start of the state convention. It's been seconded by Debbie Brown. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye and raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay and raise your hand.
Nay.
The ayes have it. With that, we have one other resolution that this gentleman has been patiently talking about. Okay, one meeting. Go ahead with your resolution, then we'll get to the announcement. Please, sir.
Mr. Chairman, Hank Smith, District 38, I have a resolution. Whereas district chairs generally and commendably balance facility use cost and maximize participation in setting district convention fees, and whereas excessive state convention fees interfere unnecessarily with participation in the state Republican convention, now, therefore, be it resolved, the fees at the state convention be balanced between facility cost and participation considerations.
Is there a second?
Here.
Okay, second, name and district.
Jeff Milton, 31.
All those in favor signify by saying aye and raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed signify by nay and raise your hand. Motion passes. Okay, we are done with new business unless there is some. I hear none. We'll go to announcements. Go right ahead. Go to the microphone.
Steve Dugan, District 13, is going to start at the point of information. And it's clarified there will be no
just go ahead and do it, sir.
Anybody here on Constitution or any other committee, can you let me know whether or not a platform plank was passed regarding the state's power to, or the state's authority, I should say, to accept gold or silver as legal tender?
I wasn't there enough. They kicked me out of the building.
Okay, sorry. Well, with that in mind, I make a motion for the following resolution. Whereas it is the constitutional authority for the state of Alaska under, and this can be corrected if I'm wrong, Article 1, Section 10, to accept gold and silver as legal tender, therefore the Alaska Republican Party supports any legislation at the state level which grants the state to allow for these competing currencies, that being gold and silver, and urge the U.S. congressional representatives and senators to stand behind any such legislation so enacted.
I second that.
Okay, the motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye and raising your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed signify nay and raise your hand. Motion passes. And you have a resolution. Please raise it.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sean Godfrey, District 23. I'm introducing a resolution of censure. Quick point of information.
Just go ahead and read it. Be fine, sir.
Let it be resolved that we, what our groups can be called, censure the following groups and individuals. Any candidates for office in attendance who refuse to sign in. All party officers not in attendance without good cause. All those who took action detrimental to the party by discouraging delegates from attending. All those delegates who attended and did not sign in. I also give forth the following names for censure.
Okay, no listed names. You can list those later because that would be, you can't get them all at once.
Oh yeah, we did.
Randy, I guess.
Mr. Chairman, it will be fairly quick.
Go ahead, Dennis.
The following individuals, Randy Reuter, Frank McQuarrie, Steve Strait, Glenn Clary, Bruce Schulte, Kirk Wickersham, Christine Hill, and Katkin Burt.
I second that motion.
Wait, Paulette Simpson.
Okay.
We missed Paulette Simpson.
Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion signify.
I'm on amendment.
Debate microphone right back here.
I would amend that to include Gloria Shriver.
Okay. I want to amend it, Gloria Shriver. Okay, under debate, any debate on this? Microphone back to the room, please.
Dick Chapman, District 19. I just want to offer an amendment. Steve Strait that was listed there is not a delegate. He did not sign it. That was the purpose for it, that is.
Very good. Are you asking for his name to be removed?
Yes, sir.
Okay, is there an objection to Steve Strait's name being removed?
I'm
objecting Steve Strait as a party officer.
Okay,
yeah, I got
all
it.
Right.
Yeah.
The lady behind you, please.
I would like to amend that to include Frank Burry. Wasn't he?
He was on. I have a friendly amendment.
Okay, under debate. Anybody up right there and then over to this gentleman. Go ahead.
was, but Michael Malin, District 32. I agree with the motions behind this, but I am kind of against it because, you know, we have kind of a victory with the party leadership. This just seems like being sore losers. I think it'll look bad on us. To me, it looks like being sore losers.
But actually, we are the winners. This is just going to take a little while.
Over here, Big Mara.
We're coming.
Perry, District 12, and I must speak to the last gentleman's comment. We were elected by the good citizens in the state of Alaska to represent our districts. We have an obligation and a responsibility to fulfill our duties, and they showed up and they refused to do what they were elected to do.
Thank you. This gentleman over here.
I just need to add Paulette. I'm making a friendly amendment to add Paulette Simpson to the list.
Okay. Objection to Paulette Simpson being added. Hearing
Paulette
none.
Simpson. Please sorry, added. I forgot.
Okay, gentlemen in the back of the room. Name and district, please.
Jeffrey Olber from District 32. I'm with Michael. Look, I know everybody's upset, but what does this accomplish? We want to move forward. They know what they did. We know what they did. Everybody knows what happens. By telling them, oh, you were bad, I think that hurts the party going forward. We need to work together and say, all right, we're done.
All right. Is there any other comments under debate before I call for the question? Gentlemen here, name and district, please.
Bill Tobel, District 25. Not everybody who needs to know knows.
Okay, lady back here at the back of the room. Lady back here, under debate on the motion. Name and district, please.
Vicki Checkon, District 14. You know, we all claim to be good Christians, and really think in your heart. You know, these people have stood up, they've put time, talent, treasure to the best of their ability. I know there are some things that they have done that people don't agree with, but that's why we have elected a new group to come in, and we're trying to unify. And the more we divide, it's not going to heal. Think from your heart.
How Christ-like were they?
Under debate, anybody else under debate? The gentleman right behind you. Name and district, please.
Mike Alexander, District 10. I totally agree with the lady before me. We won. Why push them down the mud now? We won. They have had their last convention. The next to ours, they can't make up the rules. Therefore, why put out some petty, vindictive thing like this? It looks pretty petty.
Sure. Okay, under debate, this lady right up here and then in the back of the room. Under debate on the motion. Name and district, please.
Bernadette Rubright, District 9. I'm sorry, but we need to register these names. These are officers that have not fulfilled their duty, and it is certainly appropriate to have a list.
Okay, Jerry, in the back of the room. Right after him, you're up to bat.
Which one?
Back there somewhere. I didn't hear see who it was.
I agree with the two individuals over there. I don't see a reason to really kick someone on the way out. I don't agree with what they did. However, I think that a lot of what they did was wrong. It was out of fear and out of ignorance. I don't think that if they knew us, that they would, some of them wouldn't have done what they did.
Under debate, anybody is in the right.
I'm not quite done.
Okay,
I think that if we continue this fight, we will cause problems and not be able to win elections, because some of these people we're going to have to still work with. And some of them can be brought over to our side and can learn the error of their ways. But not if we're still fighting.
Under debate, gentlemen over here.
Christianity was brought up. I'm pretty sure what these people have done was not very Christ-like.
Exactly.
That's my first point.
Okay, let Rita go first. Yeah. Rita, you have the floor.
Rita Flagg, District 33, and in a good Christian way, I was taught to smite evil when evil is done.
Thank you.
Okay, now the gentleman behind you, let him finish his talk first. Oh. You now have the floor if you want it. You want it, sir? So
did I take your phone? Did I take your
group?
Debbie, go ahead.
Debbie Brown, District 30.
She's writing all this down. That's why I keep saying
Debbie Brown, District 30. I just really
what I want to do is try to take my emotional feelings, because it really did hurt me when people who are not even signed in are signing us in. And I felt there was something going on there. And I realized, you know, these people aren't even signing in. And then, you know, here we are signing in. And it was really uncomfortable. But now, but here's what I really want to say. This is not personal. This is business.
Yep.
And if my preference is, if the business of this party is being prevented, then we need to take a business-like approach to this and figure out a way to use the rules and the rule of law and file lawsuit, take the rules into play here and apply the rules and get the rule of law, because that is what we're missing all across America and in this state and in this party.
Remember.
Now, I don't know how this plays out as to how you're going to vote on this, but that's my heart on the matter, and I have to decide right now whether I'm going to support what we're doing here with this motion or not based on that fact. But this is business. This is serious politics and business.
Okay. The motion is... The question they call for, anybody under debate would like to speak before we vote on this?
I do.
Hand the microphone to this gentleman over here.
I just want to say quickly, someone said that they're on their way out the door. Many of these people are here till at least the next 2014.
Okay. That's all right, very good. Anybody else? The lady right in the middle, okay? Would you like to speak? Okay. After her. All right, then we're going to go ahead. Name and district.
Laura Temple, District 12. I agree completely with Debbie, and the issue to me is that this is an issue of ethics, and we need to keep in mind, sure, people have their feelings, strong feelings. They're not all the same feelings. There's accusations of people being vindictive or the action being vindictive. Well, maybe they feel a little bit that way, but that's not what this is about. We're not about trying to figure out what somebody's thinking or their motivation, or that is getting, you know, we're not psychiatrists, okay? We are delegates. We stood up, made a decision to put ourselves out there to be elected as delegates to represent our communities. We signed up. We, you know, when we paid our money, that's signing on the dotted line. We agreed to do a job.
Thank you. All
so,
right.
You know,
all right.
Everyone needs to do
the job. To the motion. Anybody want to speak to the motion?
No, it's one more.
Go ahead, sir. To the motion.
Ethan Perry, District 26. We just have to remember, it's not just us here versus everyone else that's not here. There's a large third group of people that feel like they're caught in the middle between, you know, us and the elite establishment people. And we need to be careful as we are considering this vote not to appear petty, because we could further alienate good conservative, Tea Party type people, even some Ron Paul people that didn't show up here, that may feel that we're just being petty. And we would rather bring them to our side to work with us than feel like they need to work against us.
All right, the motion is to inform the Republican Party, the delegation and everybody else from the minutes that we're not happy with these people that did not sign in, and encourage others not to come. That's the motion before us. Would anybody like to speak to that motion before I call for the question? Jack over here.
I really appreciate
the name and district.
Please. Jack Brown, District 30. I really appreciate the people that are bringing up caution. And when I was an elected official for 14 years, I spoke very similarly to you guys. But when I look around this room, the people that were abused, I'm going to vote for it.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Is there anybody else in the debate before I call for the question? Because we do have some closing announcements that some people would like to make. This gentleman back here in the white shirt would like to speak to the motion. Is that correct, sir?
That's correct.
Yes. Name and district, please.
My name is Paul Kim. I'm in District 18, and I would ask this, and that is that you define the level of betrayal. You need to define this, ladies and gentlemen, exactly what was betrayed, what the principle was, so that this cannot occur again without accountability. I understand you're not after the person. We're all fallible and sometimes go awry. It is the fundamental principles under which you organize and we hold sacred above our petty differences. So I would suggest that you at least define the level of betrayal, whether it's an encroachment, whether it's an assault, this degree, and it's a point of origin, so it doesn't happen again. Like any child that's out of line, this clearly confused us, the general public, who's not participating in your take back America.
The lady in the middle, under debate. Hey, we're getting...
District 22. I just feel insulted because, you know, I brought my whole family, we're all delegates, and that's several thousand dollars. And I feel like it was calculated way back at the first time that this was going to be a mess this time, and we cut the meeting short. And for them to say, oh yeah, come back and find out what the results are, and we'll continue business then, and then have all of us come here with thousands of dollars to try and continue and be patriots, and then they slap us in the face by saying, well, too bad you came, you know, we told everybody to stay home. Well, you know, when you spend, you know, $500 to $600, you know, twice, and we had help this time, but, you know, good people from all of the United States, you know, pitched in so that we could get together today. Right. And I'm really sick about this, and they should be called out. They sit there in front of us as leaders of the party, you know, being in charge of most of the thing for the last 4 years, and then they said, well, we're not going to vote, and we told them all our friends to stay home. And then we all come from all of the, you know, Alaska, and here we are, you know, just saying, well, look at you. Yet, you know, what is this gonna, you know, I think you should be called out, and I think everybody, you know, should call them out in the media too. And they should pay for what they're doing. I think they should be booted out and new people take their place.
Under debate, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye and raise your hand.
Aye.
All those opposed signify by nay and raise your hand.
Nay.
The ayes have it. Okay, under announced, yes, sir. Under new business.
A motion to hear that the resolutions which we have just passed, that George Martin or other nominations that could be made, be the person who would be able to deliver these to the SEC, seeing as how he is a member on the SEC as a protected portion.
But that would be fine. The motion was to deliver it there so the three people will give it to George.
No, all of the resolutions which we have made,
right.
He is on the SEC, that he himself delivers it to.
The motion that is being made that the three-member committee that's going to approve the minutes, because we are going to write them after we're gone because we're not having another meeting, is to hand those minutes over to George Martin. Is there a second?
Second.
Bill 33, Justin Carroll, second.
Or other nominees.
Just the minutes of this meeting. Okay, all right. And that will be done. We don't, I've just been assured we don't need a motion on that. It'll be done.
Okay.
All right. Is there any other new business? Hearing none, we're going to now go to announcements. Are there any announcements? If so, come right. Okay. All right. And then, but now after the announcements, we're going to adjourn. We're going to turn the, don't leave, we're going to turn the microphone over to Russ, the chairman-elect.
Okay, Rebecca Logan, District 23. I'm also the Region 6 Finance Chair on the SCC, and I'm the General Manager for the Alaska Support Industry Alliance. This week we were handed a very good gift from APOC on independent expenditure, so I want to invite every single person who is in this room who is so excited about being more involved in the Republican Party to get involved in what we have going, which I won't discuss in detail because we have media here who supports the opposition and we don't need it in the paper. We have the opportunity to work on Republican candidates, getting Republican candidates elected, and on coastal zone management. That is a critical ballot initiative. Okay? And so if you're interested in helping getting Republicans elected with independent expenditures and coastal zone management, you can contact me at the Alliance.
Okay, and exactly what his connections are in the world, too. Is there anything under announcements? George?
Chairman, I make a motion to adjourn.
Okay, motion adjourn. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, we are adjourned. Don't leave. I'm turning it over now for a few comments from our chairman-elect, Ruff.
I want to give Jerry a hand, please. outstanding job. We need you back in general. Thank you very much. I want to thank Gene Brokaw and Margaret for their generosity in providing the majority of the money for this event. Just a couple of things. Some minor things and some big things. I don't know who returned my pin to me, but I want to thank them. I've lost two pins. Fortunately, I said this, and I thought I wouldn't buy another one because I didn't have any money. So I still have this one after 3 years, so that's good. There's a bag flying around someplace that's white that I gave out this morning to somebody that had food in it for snacks. If you have that, could you return it? It belongs to my wife. There's another bag that went around, and I hope you all enjoyed those snacks in there that were provided by other people. And whoever provided those snacks, I want to thank them. You can thank my wife, Tish. Tish, thank you.
Thank you, Tish.
So, Tish and I have been married for 16 years. For 16 years, I've been wearing sunglasses because when she smiles, I need to have some sunglasses. All right, we've collected $1,624.60. Thank you very much. That covers our expenses for Mr. Merritt, which includes his plane fare. We spent $200 in this facility. Gene's going to write a check for that. If you want to help him, please see Gene. That's my last request for money, which he's been very kind to put up all this money in advance, and I appreciate it very much. I want to thank you all for coming, expressing what you've expressed. My goal in this meeting today was for you to all have a voice. You've all heard me say I want to return the Republican Party, at least in this state, to its legacy for the common man and the common woman, the common person, to have a voice at the table. You've all got to express yourself today. Some of the things that you wanted were passed, some that you weren't, but nobody was discouraged from expressing themselves. That's what I look forward to in the next 2 years under my chairmanship. So thank you all for coming. If you have any more questions, I'll be in here. David, did you have anything you wanted to say to candidates that didn't get to campaign?
Russ,
yes.
I'd like to say God bless you, and I wish you well in your new job coming up.
Thank you, Jerry. Enjoyed being here. I love this kind of debate. Margaret, do you have a question? Or?
No, I just want to say thank you to everybody for attending,
yes.
And thank you for the donations. We really appreciate
so
it.
So let's look forward to more of these. Okay?
All right, the convention is now over. Everything we came to do is now done. The next order of business are the campaigns. So on behalf of myself and all the other candidates who some of you have generously donated to, I want to thank you. That money will be well spent. Are there any candidates still here in the room? If so, I'd like to invite you to come up to the front so that we can see you. I know in my case, I would love to tell you all about my campaign. But I know Mr. Cox, candidate here. Anyone else still here in the room that is currently running for office?
Yeah, hi, my name is Chris Eichenlohe. I'm running for state rep in District 18. Really concerned about the losses of freedom that have been going on, and I think the state's a good place to start where we can really stick up for our individual liberties and personal freedoms. And it's just something I'm looking forward to working for.
Hey, John Cox here, District 30. Did you get that? You know, I want to let everybody know about myself. I didn't get to mention this at the district or the first gathering. I don't consider myself a politician. I consider myself a statesman. And that's what our founding fathers wanted. They wanted us to go do a job and then come back home. Right? And I told this to a few other individuals, but I truly believe, and I would do this for free. Because it is a civic duty. That being said, that's, you know, please, there's a lot of you in here. I know there's a lot of questions. And the way you can help me win back this country is to pay it forward. And when I say pay it forward, tell the person, tell two people, and have them tell two people about me, okay? I want you to vote. I want your vote because it's the right choice, not because you saw my name 100 more times on the street than my opponent, okay? People have gotten so used to going into that ballot or the election booth, and they see that other, my opponent's name, and right away, they put the little check there.
Your opponent, let's hear who you're running against.
My opponent is Don Young. There it is. This is the David and Goliath, and I am the David, okay? With that said, peace be with you.
You're running for office. Yes? No? This is just for candidates right now. Sorry. Nope. Only candidates.
Wait just a second. I feel like I'm with the TSA here. So. I don't want to get questioned. I don't need a microphone to voice up. I'm Paul D. Kendall. I'm a candidate in the I District against Elks. I cut my own trail. I don't take time to a man querying my integrity and holding onto a microphone.
Now, if you're a candidate, I can have
I'm not a man who pushes my own respect. Now, the younger sometimes the younger men need to realize that this old dog's still got a little bite left. Now, no offense to this gentleman, it is my position, these are Lord of the Rings days, it belongs to our young men. But you older men need to get back in the saddle and you need to convey to the young men. I'm running against Ellis and District I, as I said earlier. But you should understand something. I represent not just a political pursuit, ladies and gentlemen. There is something moving very, very large, and it's called coal fusion. And I know you're all thinking that's not possible. Believe you me, you're about to see some intersection of lights you've never seen. They think it's going to breach in the next 6 to 18 months. I went to AEA and ADA, I went to their board meeting, and I told them you need to bring these four companies up right now and put them on camera for our young men to see. If this new technology launches, the likes of which they're now saying that a square mile of ocean water contains enough energy to equal all the oil on the planet, if they get traction, we're down. But if they bring these men up here, these companies, and we launch, Alaska could literally be the next Atlantis or Atlantean society. This is an opportunity of a lifetime. I told AEA and ADA I would not lay down on this. This belongs to our young men. I think I'm going over time. I feel Mr. Millett getting ready to shut me down. I thank you for the opportunity to come and see the real people. I felt like for a long time I've been assaulted by the socialists who want to turn me into a drone, and the tyrannists who want me to turn into the new worker order, new oral order worker. The Ron Paulers I've always held close to my heart as being those people who understand individual free will. And I apologize to the young man again, but I've been attending the Schaefer Cox trial, and then Marsh has been beating up on me over there.
This is Mr. Kendall. How many of you want to see Johnny Ellis stay in office? Raise your hand. None. How many of you want to see him defeated? Raise your hand. Thank you.
Don't you just wait to judge me. I'm a bad boy. Don't you think for a moment. Let me get something real stranger. I'm used to dog fights. I got lots of scars. I'm a simple man, but you just vote your own lead there, ladies and gentlemen.
He said we might look like each other when I met him. Do you think we look like each other? We're brothers, but we're brothers from different mothers, so thank you. Yeah, thank you. All right, I want to say one more thank you to a young lady that has done a wonderful job and was not recognized. Her name is Zephra. Zephra, you have a little resume for their information? Right here. All right, Zephra, age 21. She's not a student now, went to homeschool, then Alaska Bible Institute for 3 years. She volunteered to take these notes. I want to give her a round of applause and thank her for the time.
Senate race that involves Palmer and Valdez and Fairbanks and everywhere in between. It's going to be the race to watch this year. It's a four-way race. Blake Bishop, Bill Ward, Ralph Stevens, myself, all running. The reason that I'm running is because I want to see Alaska take the lead nationally against federal overreach in every area of our lives. I want to empower parents. I want to empower parents to choose the best education for their children. I have lots of ideas how to do that. I want to empower our state legislators to stand up and represent us against the very overreaching issues such as healthcare, education as well. There's a long, long list, and I know a lot of us could be here for a long, long time talking about it. I'd like to empower individuals at each level to take responsibility for their lives, locally, at the borough level. We've got boroughs and non-borough folks in our district. And I have the privilege of running in a Senate district, both House districts of which were won in the presidential primary by Ron Paul. There's a lot of conservatives in my district. And in a four-way race, I can say whatever I want to say. So, watch the race. It's going to be exciting. Donate to the candidate who will represent your values best. Thank you.
So somebody else wants to say something.
I do, actually.
You can do it without a microphone, I think.
I don't need a microphone. Okay. I feel personally actually insulted that we insulted the only media that came here today. Okay. I don't care if she was a card-carrying communist, okay? I don't care. First of all, we're all for free speech. So if she doesn't agree with what we agree, I don't care. She showed up.
Yeah.
That's all I got to say.
Daryl, thank you very much.
All right, sorry.
Hear ye, hear ye. Do I hear any objection to adjourning this conclave?
So moved.
So moved. Thank you very much for coming. God bless you all.
Hey, David.
Yeah.
This is more of a rhetorical question. How do you feel about school choice?
Yeah.
This was just one of those days. It worked. You can see the Velcro from my first attempt.